It's time for Windows Weekly. Paul Thurrott and Mary Jo Foley are here after an exhausting week trying to understand what Microsoft means when they say they won't support old versions of Windows on new hardware. What? We'll explain all next on Windows Weekly.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit.
Bandwidth for Windows Weekly is provided by CacheFly at CacheFly.com.
This is Windows Weekly with Paul Thurrott and Mary Jo Foley, episode 449 for Wednesday, January 20th, 2016. Noob tubing. Windows Weekly is brought to you by Audible.com. To download the free audiobook of your choice, go to audible.com/windows. And by Harry's. Stop overpaying for a great shave and start the new year off right. Go to harrys.com. Get $5 off your first purchase by entering the code Windows when you check out. And by Wealthfront. Wealthfront is a low-cost automated investment service that is the most sophisticated way for you to invest your money. Whether you've got millions or just starting out, visit Wealthfront.com to sign up and get your free personalized investment portfolio. That's Wealthfront.com/windows. It's time for Windows Weekly, the show where we get together with some of the brightest minds in the Microsoft world to talk about what's going on up there.
And then us too.
And then them. You, the listeners, are the brightest minds, but we have no. Paul Thurrott is here. I realized this morning, I was thinking, you know what? Paul's a raconteur.
Wow.
You know why I was thinking about that? I was thinking about your Yale Club story. And I thought, you know what? He's a natural storyteller.
Oh, for some reason. Okay, I misunderstood.
No, a raconteur. I bet you when you gather with the guys, you tell stories. You tell long jokes with obscure punchlines, that kind of thing.
Yep.
Mary Jo's laughing. Mary Jo's also here.
Well, Mary Jo is often the recipient of the stories.
I know. So. Is he a raconteur? I think he is.
He is.
I think he's a storyteller.
He is.
And I mean that in the best way. Like Mark Twain was a raconteur.
Yeah.
Right?
Yep. Oh, okay.
Yeah. You've got great stories. Keep them up.
Okay.
And we'll try to give you new fodder for those stories. In fact, Steve Gibson said, would you ask Paul and Mary Jo what the hell is going on?
Oh, because of Twitter?
No. Yeah, I did see that. I did see that. And by the way, how's your...
We had a little thing about Steve Gibson on Twitter last week.
Yeah. But no, that wasn't this. This is one you wanted to ask about. But actually, I do want to ask before we go farther. Your son's okay?
Yeah. Yes.
Good. Yeah. Is he home?
Yeah. Yep.
Good. All went well.
Yep.
I didn't know that he had a cochlear implant. How's that been working for him?
Yeah, very well. That's why, you know, you got to be careful with this kind of thing because when if you get an infection, it could require resurgery and we don't want that.
So they were just careful. They were just watching carefully. Good.
Yeah, he was not happy about it, but I don't think he understands the gravity of the situation. He was a kid. So.
Yeah. Hey, but does it help him hear? I mean, is he able to hear pretty
well? Oh, yeah. No, you wouldn't. Honestly, if you just had a conversation with him, you wouldn't even know.
Isn't
but he's 100% completely deaf. Yeah.
And yeah.
But he doesn't slur his speech at all. He doesn't, you know, he's
amazing.
It's technology in action.
Yeah. Yeah. I remember talking to Vint Cerf, whose wife was deaf, about her cochlear implant maybe 10 or more years ago. It was an early one. And then, of course, we've all seen the video of the young woman who went to the doctor's office and heard for the first time.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's amazing. It's amazing.
You don't have to tell me.
No, I know. I know.
I know.
And I just I was reminded of it by your Facebook pictures. I hope you don't mind me bringing it up on the show. And if you do, we can edit it right out.
No, it's okay. It's okay.
You know, we're.
It's been a long week.
Yeah, I bet it has. I bet it has. But I'm glad he's doing well.
Yep.
That's great. No, what Steve wanted me to ask you guys about was, what does this thing mean that Microsoft isn't going to support?
Oh, well, listen.
Older processors.
Leo, here's the thing. This is only a
newer
pod.
It's confusing. Newer processors. It's not that they're not going to support older processors, but if you get a new processor, you can't run older Windows on it. You have to run Windows 10 on it. Is that right? Am I saying that correctly? Sort of.
Mostly.
I tried to parse Terry Meyerson's blog post, and I didn't.
Yeah, we all do.
So I figured you guys would.
I don't know. How do we even talk about this? Because I, you know, Mary. And by the way, you would talk about storytelling. I mean, Mary Jo knows too. For me, Friday was an absolute disaster because of this story. And without getting into the particulars, I mean, I spoke to many, many people about this, and I have some more information about it, and maybe some context for it, and all that kind of stuff. But
we should name this show "Embracing Silicon Innovation."
Yeah, so
because right, that so is by, the most. Okay.
All right, right, okay, right, right. So, by the way, that you've just highlighted one of what I think are about 121 issues with this post, and this post is not about Windows 10 embracing silicon innovation at all. Like every new version of Windows supports new hardware features. That's nothing new.
Right.
But unfortunately for Microsoft, in trying to hide the story, hide the lead, I guess they choose to highlight Windows 10 when in fact this is really about Windows 7 and Windows 8.1.
So, it's funny. Mary Jo's the saner.
Yeah, she's, would you please?
Let the same person talk for a little while.
Great. Well, on Friday, neither of us were sane. And Paul and I talked several times on the phone where we both were just like yelling things out at each other like, what do you think this means?
Yeah, it's crazy.
Jeez.
So, yeah, it was a hectic day. But here's the gist of it. I'll try to boil it down a little bit. That blog post that Microsoft put out on Friday is saying that going forward, if you buy new hardware, you've got to count on running Windows 10 on it and not think about downgrading to an earlier version of Windows. But the thing that makes this murky is there's this interim period between now and July 17th, 2017, where Microsoft's going to give mostly business users, because this is mostly about business users, some time to try to get used to this new rule. So what they did was they changed the rules around how long they support older versions of Windows, which is something I don't think they've ever done.
And by the way, I think we've confirmed now they've never done this before.
Okay.
Since they established this 5.5 support policy.
Right.
Okay. And by the way, the people who most would want to run older versions of Windows on new hardware are businesses, right? I mean, that's why it's an enterprise issue.
Which, again, by the way, going back to that headline, the issue I have with the headline and my contention that this is really about Windows 7 and Windows 8.1, it's really about business users too, right? I mean, primarily. And for some reason, this thing is never going to be centered. Okay. Anyway.
Right. Because the reason this is about business users is how many consumers go out there and they buy a new PC and then they go, oh, let me go back to Windows 7 on this. That's not what that's not what consumers do, right?
Well,
a lot of my listeners do it, but okay.
Yeah, I was going to say yes and no. I mean, I actually think the audience that does that is very small.
That's
but
true.
I would say when a new version of Windows comes out for that first, year, a lot of times people want to go back to an older version because maybe they're game players and they perceive that there's extra performance from the older version of Windows or something like that. But yeah, you're right. Mostly it's obviously businesses. Right. And by the way, Windows Pro exists specifically to give them those downgrade rights. That's one of the points of that release for businesses.
Right. A lot of businesses, they are on different schedules for hardware and software. So sometimes they have to go out and their budget says, okay, go buy a bunch of new PCs now. But we're all running Windows 7 over here. So we want you to actually run Windows 7 on that older hardware. This is the scenario that this affects the most, because these users now are going to get a list from Microsoft of PCs that they'll be able to downgrade to Windows 7 if they're running a Skylake processor. And if your PC is not on that list, you're not going to be able to do that and still be supported by Microsoft. So that's the group of people who are kind of freaking out about this right now, who should be.
You know, I'm going to read this here. It says, forward.
Actually,
you want to start with the first one? Here's the new policy changes with these three bullets.
I think there's a new, actually, maybe it's the third. Yeah, let's look at that third one first, actually. I think this is relates
first,
to what you
this
just
is
said.
The one that will.
This is one of the many weird things about this post. This weird 18-month period where for certain configurations, and we don't know what those are yet, meaning each PC maker will come out with some kind of a compatibility list. You'll be able to buy a current generation Skylake device, downgrade it to Windows 7. Microsoft will fully support it under whatever terms of support we have right now for Windows 7 or Windows 8.1. And then after July 2017, they expect people or companies to upgrade to Windows 10. But actually, if you read the second sentence there, it says, after July 2017, the most critical security updates for those older versions of Windows will be addressed, meaning that this is really funny when you think about it. That means nothing has changed. Because if you're in Windows 7 or
Maybe.
Well, I would say, realistically speaking, nothing's changed.
Well, you're still going to get urgent security updates as long as it, and that's the second sentence, doesn't affect the reliability or compatibility of these machines.
Right.
Also, urgent security updates is where I'm kind of stumbling because right now Windows 7 is in extended support, which means you only get security updates, right? That sentence to me says, you might not get all of them.
Just the most critical.
Yeah, right. Well, okay. So let me frame. I'm just trying to frame what that means. Yeah. In extended support, like Mary Jo just said, you only get security updates, essentially. Yeah. That's on paper. Like on paper, for the first 5 years you get of mainstream support, you get new features as well as security updates and other updates. Realistically speaking, Microsoft is not adding new features to any version of Windows for the first 5 years it's out. Windows 10 is an obvious exception. Things have completely changed with Windows 10. But, you know, if you look at Windows 7, Windows 8.1, well, actually Windows 8.1, Windows 8 was so screwed up they actually did add new features. But typically, you're not getting a lot of new features. Realistically speaking, once you hit the back end of that 10-year cycle, the extended support part, you're not getting anything other than the most critical fixes. Microsoft's just willy-nilly throwing out fixes for everybody. They want to keep that stuff to a minimum. And so on paper, you are potentially getting less than you would have before this change. But I think realistically speaking, it's going to be about the same as you would have gotten before. I mean, you're not getting new features. We already know that. I don't really think a lot has changed. I spoke with Mike Nash from HP, and we talked about this on the record. And he said, you know, he doesn't see this as a big deal, which I find it a very interesting perspective because Mary Jo and I were freaking out. I mean, freaking out on Friday. And
Mary Jo, were you freaking out? What is it that is so scary about this?
I think it's scary because if you are a business customer, you've always kind of been able to count on Microsoft behaving in a set way in terms of support.
This was
the first time where they changed the rules and didn't give a lot of heads up, frankly. I mean, they gave you a year and a half till next year in July. But for businesses, that's not a lot of time.
Yeah.
Which, by the way, is why I came up with an awesome Godfather graphic for my version.
You did.
Are we getting an offer we can't refuse? Is that
yes?
Is that
that's exactly the tagline. And the thing is, you just pray I don't alter the terms of this deal any further. If you want to go Empire Strikes Back on us or whatever, but I think a lot of things are just a matter of context and of understanding and so forth. And from my perspective, certainly, and I think Mary Jo would agree with this. For the past, 6 months or whatever, ever since Windows 10 came out, ever since before Windows 10 came out, one of the things we've been sort of dealing with is this notion of Microsoft really pushing Windows 10 aggressively on existing customers on Windows 7 and Windows 8.1. Mary Jo's experienced this firsthand. And, I've had these conversations with people at Microsoft, and and Chris Capasola said the same thing, they don't really apologize for it. They know they're being very aggressive. I find the tactics to be a little bit much. They're escalating all the time. I agree with Microsoft that the world would be better off if more and more people move forward to Windows 10 for all the security reasons and simplicity of updating and so forth. But I also recognize that some people simply don't want that. They want to make their own decisions, or maybe there are valid reasons that they're stuck on a previous version of Windows, whatever. So it's hard for me, and certainly on Friday it was hard for me, not to see this announcement in the light of we are aggressively pushing Windows 10 on everybody. And just that week, remember, the previous story along these lines was now we're opening up the Get Windows 10 advertisement or whatever you want to call it to domain-attached users for the first time. This is unprecedented. Now, granted, it's very specific types of customers. It's essentially small customers who have kind of cloud-based infrastructure rather than on-prem Active Directory infrastructure, but they're still managed computers. These are still computers that should never see something like this. And of course, they are giving tools away so that you can prevent it from appearing. But you know, it's just an escalation. It's an escalation. It's an escalation. And then this announcement comes out, and it's like, baloney, 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 baloney. Oh, look, we changed Windows 7 and Windows 8. Windows, whoa, 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 what? You know, and so it was.
Can I just back up just a sec?
Absolutely.
And because I think we launched right into the middle of this, assuming everybody understands what's happened here. Let me,
yes.
Let me just kind of say what this new thing kind of, at least my understanding of it.
By the way, I challenge you to describe this.
Yeah.
Because it is so nuanced. But go ahead.
Yeah. Well, I want you to add the nuance to what I'm about to say, because it will not be nuanced. So, you know, everybody understands the notion that new versions of software may not support old hardware. That's understandable.
Every version of Windows. Yep.
Yeah. And Microsoft has always in the past really worked hard to support legacy hardware and legacy software. That they're famous for that. It's one of the reasons they've succeeded in enterprise.
Mm-hmm.
This isn't that. This is kind of turning that on its head.
It is.
Saying if you get new hardware, we won't guarantee, in fact, we won't probably allow you to run anything but Windows 10 on it that's starting, you know, July 2017. You know what, and then one more thing I want to say, which is, and what they said was, and this was the thing that I didn't know, and I wanted to ask the experts, all along, we patch the old versions, Windows 7, Windows 8, Windows maybe Vista, I don't know, to work with new hardware, like when the implication being when Intel's Haswell platform came out, we had to push out fixes to Windows 7 so it would work with this is what they're saying, so it would work with Haswell. This is a bit of a shock to me because, as far as I could tell, Intel has been very as good, as assiduous as Microsoft at preserving compatibility.
You know what, we don't actually know the full story there. That's what I just found out on
that's
Monday.
My question. My first question is, is this the case that Microsoft has all along been patching old versions of Windows to work when new processors come out? Actually, and we should systems on a chip as opposed to just CPU.
Because it's not just the processor. There's a lot of support chips going on there as well.
X86 doesn't change. But there's other stuff that might
change. So this is what I found out. First of all, what you said about system on chip is very important. I think that's the complexity of that kind of a design plays into the issues we're seeing here. What I found out was that every single time a new chip comes out, I think we would assume, just because we sort of used to the compatibility and how things work, and you would sort of assume that a new gen Intel processor would just be backwards compatible. And of course it would. Like, why would, you know, that's not the case at all. And there has to be work done from driver makers, PC makers, OS makers, and all kinds of things to ensure that this stuff works properly. And every single time there's a problem.
And this kind of surprises me because, as an example, you can take an old version of Linux, a 10-year-old version of Linux, and run it on a Skylake processor.
Yeah. Now, Linux, now, I don't know enough.
Well,
I don't
but
know
one
a lot
thing
about
that
it,
happens, and I think this maybe explains it, is the kernel does work. But what happens is when you install on a new machine, you get a lot of new drivers, and those are updated. And so there is additional software that comes with an operating system that does need to be updated. And if that's the case, I can see why Microsoft might, for the first time ever, say, we're going to end of life old process.
I think the capabilities have gotten so impressive. Sorry to talk about
that. Part of the end of I'm not complaining about you. I'm trying to understand. Part of the end of life of a operating system will include support for new processors.
Yeah, the irony of what happened here, I think, is that I thought, I don't want to speak for Mary Jo, but I saw this in the as a yet another way to jam, you know, Windows 10 down people's throats.
Well, it can look like that, right? Yeah. It's like, we're going to force you to upgrade.
Right. And I would say my calmer morning after I've learned a little bit more information kind of attitude is that it really kind of isn't that. But the ironic bit is, at the end of the day, they're still getting to the same position. Because now they've created a precedent, and they've stated explicitly going forward, new versions of silicon, so not just Intel, but AMD, Qualcomm, whatever, will only be supported by the latest version of Windows. And ultimately, they've arrived at the same thing, which I was worried about, which is that when future versions, Kaby Lake, which is the next gen, is sort of service pack one for Skylake or whatever. I don't remember what the one coming after that is, but Intel's working on a 10 nanometer process for that. New Qualcomm.
Is that what that is?
I can't remember. You know, this stuff will only support Windows 10. So, you know, for most people on the people listening to this, people who are not IT pros and don't have to support this stuff at work, it's not a big deal because obviously you always get the newest version of Windows on the newest on the new computer. That's the way life is. You know, we're used to that. Businesses, this is going to create an interesting situation. In talking to Mike Nash, you know, he was telling me that the range of HP computers that we supported on Skylake with Windows 7, and he said no one is asking for Windows 8.1. It's all Windows 7. And that, by the way, this is not uncommon. This is something they go through with every Windows version. It's going to be pretty big. It's a much bigger list than you might imagine. And he doesn't know, but you know, you'd imagine that the companies that support businesses, like I would include Dell and Lenovo in that list, are probably going to have pretty broad support for Windows 7 on Skylake. And so it makes me wonder about, you know, so let's say Kaby Lake, right? So 1 year from now, new Kaby Lake based PCs are coming out. Obviously, they're going to come out with Windows 10. Will companies, PC makers, be able to offer Windows 7 downgrade rights to those machines?
I don't know. I mean, it seems to say that they can't.
So Microsoft has just made a very Godfather-esque change to the agreement, haven't they, then? Because this is something that companies have been doing for over a decade, you know, maybe decades, downgrading. This is part of the Windows Pro upgrade rights or license rights. Does this really change that as well? Because that's a major, major change.
Yep. I asked, when I talked to a couple of people at Microsoft, I asked specifically about downgrade rates. And I said, what happened? This to me is like you guys drawing the line in the sand and saying, that's it for downgrade rates. And I couldn't really get an exact confirmation of that, right? They wouldn't say, yep, you're right. That's the end of downgrade. But the way that blog post is worded, I would say yes.
Wow.
I think that means,
that's crazy, isn't it?
What are you hearing, Mary Jo, from your enterprise users about this?
Right. So a few enterprise users like on Twitter are like, what the heck? Like, what? Like, are you kidding me? And people at first were like, I don't think you're explaining this right. This can't be what this says. And I'm like, I just ran my blog post past Microsoft after I published it. And I said, am I saying correctly what this blog post said? And they said, yes. So I think, yeah, it's pretty big. It's big. If you're a company that kind of has, like many enterprises, I would say, has a set way of doing things, a schedule that they look at things like a major update, like going to Windows 10 on. I wondered in my blog post if this might actually push back some people's plans to move to Windows 10, because they now may say, oh, wait a minute, we're not going to move people now until we're ready, like all the way ready, and then we're going to do it when we have people on the new hardware and the newest software. You know, obviously the PC makers don't want to hear that, and they don't want that to be the message. They don't want to hear this is going to actually slow the migration by businesses to Windows 10 and maybe slow the adoption of Skylake-based hardware. They don't want to hear that.
Nobody wants to hear that.
I mean, the message. But right.
Given what's happened with the PC industry for the past several years, right?
Yeah.
This is going to be a terrible time.
So another group that's going to be ticked by this is the OEMs.
Yeah.
And yet they sound like they're kind of supportive, or is that just because they don't want to anger the gorilla?
Well, I think they have to say it's not that bad, guys.
Welcome to the stick.
Yeah, because now Now, if it is true, and I guess it is, that Microsoft has all along been backpatching older versions of Windows to work with newer hardware, I can understand why they would say, look, there's an end of life. And are they accelerating, Mary Jo, the end of life faster than it would be accelerated? No.
Yes.
Oh, they are.
Well, that's that weird July thing, right?
Yeah.
That's that weird July date.
It's almost like they've created a third tier, you know. So we'd have to look at what.
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't know off the top of my head, like when Windows 7 extended support ends, when Windows 8.1 extended support ends. Then you can go from July 2017 to that day and say, that's a new third type of support. It's like ludicrous support, or you know, or barely support, or whatever.
What is the difference, Mary Jo? I mean,
So it's 3 years. The difference is 3 years.
So
almost.
in effect, they've come out and said, "Oh, and by the way, we're going to end of life Windows 7 3 years earlier if you have new hardware."
If you have new hardware, but we
and
should.
And by
make
the way,
really
an
clear.
End of life just means no more support. In this case, it means it won't work.
No, it means Microsoft won't patch it. Right.
Yeah, it means it's not guaranteed to work.
But they're kind of implying that if I get a Kaby Lake processor or a Qualcomm 8996 or an AMD Bristol Ridge, and I try to install Windows 7 on it, it's going to just not work.
Well, okay. So here, let's right. So we don't. This is very interesting. if you think, again, think about business PCs and think about how downgrade rights have always existed and, you know, that kind of thing. Downgrade rights are a right of the license. But, of course, for this to really work, what you need is the PC maker to be on board if you're buying from a PC maker. You know, you need to make sure that all the hardware in that device, or at least the relevant hardware in that device, will work with an older version of Windows. And so the interesting side effect of this change, which is a positive side effect for businesses, is that for the first time, PC makers are now going to be more transparent about which of their models they explicitly support in older versions of Windows. I don't want to say secretly, but they have always quietly supported X number of their own models for this purpose. In other words, a Dell or an HP or a Lenovo would say, okay, for this set of computers, we're going to provide a complete set of drivers for all of the previous existing versions of Windows that are still supported. So in this case, Windows 7 and Windows 8.1. We're just going to do that. And then there might be, think about like a tablet with a kickstand and USB-C ports, and it's multi-touch and it flips around and it's transformed. It doesn't make sense to put Windows 7 on that computer. So we're not going to support it on that, but we are going to support it on this thing that's like a laptop, or maybe it's like a touch laptop, or maybe it's an all-in-one computer, or whatever it is. There's going to be some division along those lines. Because of this change, these PC makers are, and the models they support explicitly, in this case on Windows 7, will be known to everyone. And so you as a business or you as an individual can say, hey, I want to run Windows 7, and now I know that exact PC model works. It's guaranteed to work, you know?
Guaranteed
and so
to that's work till 2017, right?
No, it will still work, right? I mean, it will never stop working.
You know, it'll work, but Microsoft may not patch it. That's what we don't know.
They may not patch it, but I mean,
the most critical security patches.
But I think for most people, most businesses, actually, that's probably okay.
That might be okay. Yep, it might be.
Yeah.
We just don't know what that means. Right. We don't know that the most critical. Like,
we also, in other words, we have critical, and now we have the most critical. You know, they've added it. Yeah, so, okay, whatever. But there's still a question mark, at least in my mind, about what happens post Skylake. So that situation I just described with the transparency and the wonderfulness of all that is for Skylake. What about Kaby Lake? What about Kaby Lake? What if somebody wants to buy, a company wants to buy, a huge company, some Fortune 500 company is going to buy thousands and thousands of Kaby Lake based whatever computers. Does HP or Dell or Lenovo certify that? And do they get to put Windows 7 on there? And will Microsoft deliver them any updates?
I know, right.
It's That's not really clear, is it? I don't think it's clear from this blog post at all. I don't have really the answer to that. I don't know,
The other thing we don't know that one of our listeners is talking about right now, Dave Panrios, he's saying, what about virtual machines, right?
Mm-hmm.
What if you put Windows 7 in a VM on Windows 10 and then run it?
Right.
What happens support-wise?
So I have to guess because I don't explicitly discuss this. I don't think that's going to change because a virtual machine by nature is a virtual machine. And I think that, you know, Microsoft's virtual technology, you know, Hyper-V stuff, they'll probably continue to support older versions during the supported lifecycle. And I'm sure they will even offer that up as a compatibility wedge for those people that really need Windows 7. But I mean, it's really amazing to me that Windows 7 embraces silicon innovation is hilarious headline for a story that's about completely changing the support of Windows 7 and Windows 8.1 out from under businesses for the first time ever. Complete surprise. It's this whole thing is really, it's really,
it just
crazy.
it felt like they were trying to hide it because of how they buried it in the Post, right. But also dropping the news on the Friday before a long holiday weekend in the U.S., that's usually a sign you're trying to hide something under the rug,
yep.
Right?
Yep, yep. I don't know if it was you or someone told you that, you know, no one ever announces good news on a Friday afternoon at 2:30 or whatever, right. You know.
Right. But again, I wanted to stress one thing because this keeps coming up with people on Twitter to me. Also, if you have an older processor like Broadway has, well, and you're running Windows 10 on it, you're fine. Or if you're running Windows 7 on it, there's no change for you. You are still supported the way you were before. You have downgrade rights. Your extended support for Windows 7 doesn't end until 2020. So you're okay. It's just the people we're talking about are people who are buying new PCs, but they want to go back to Windows 7 on those PCs.
Right. The other thing, you know, it's funny. Until Monday, I was kind of going off on a direction where I thought, you know, maybe the problem is Skylake, right? You know, maybe there's something inherently wrong with this chip. I mean, when you think back to last fall, Microsoft was the first PC maker, which is an interesting way to put it, but that shipped Skylake-based computers, Surface Book and Surface Pro 4. Those machines have and continue to have endemic hardware problems. And that Microsoft has been very quiet about to this day. And I sort of started to wonder, you know, is maybe, what if it's, you know, what if this thing's really screwed up? What if it's, this is the original Pentium all over again, like they have to recall this or something is really wrong. But talking to Mike Nash again, I got the impression that this hardware transition was no more serious than any other hardware transition. And the implication, he didn't say this, but was sort of, you know, Microsoft's kind of new to this game. I think we can all say that previous versions of Surface Pro, hardware-wise, were kind of a generation behind from an Intel chipset perspective. Mm. And I think with this one, they wanted to get onto the next thing, not the last thing. And it's the first time they ever did it. And they were first out the gate. And you have to sort of think that, I mean, all the PC makers must have been testing this stuff. But some PCs that are not Microsoft's are having problems with that Intel display driver issue. But I don't know of any having the sleep issue. And it's almost like that the Surface Book has in particular. I'm not sure about Surface Pro 4, but I assume it has the same issue. You know, it's almost like they just wanted to go full bore and be first. And it's always tough. I always feel bad for Microsoft, you know, when they really reach for the sky. And sometimes it comes back and it, you know, it doesn't work out for them. I like when they're bold like that. I mean, Surface Pro 4, Surface Book introduction was very exciting. And they're beautiful machines. There's no doubt about it. But man, it's, what are we at, 4 months now, 3 months out? And they're not fixing the problems. At least they haven't yet. And that's a concern, you know, as well.
I feel like the sleep issue is something the Surface line especially has had since the very beginning, though, right? Like, I feel like I've had trouble with not sleep so much, but power, right? Power issues and battery life quotes not matching real life and machines never going into, what's it called? Something standby.
Connected standby.
Connected standby. I had that with my Surface RT way back in the day, too. Maybe it's Skylake endemic. Maybe it's just something...
Kind of ironic if Microsoft only noticed this problem because they started making hardware.
Right. And by the way, funny. I mean, go ahead.
So I was going to say, I saw somebody tweet that and say, well, finally, Microsoft is experiencing the troubles that all its OEMs have been having for years.
And maybe they'll now fix that problem, you know, for good. Because
It does raise the issue. Maybe the OEMs were doing this backpatching more than Microsoft was.
And I think, by the way, I think everyone...
OEM, they have to, and they don't want
to. Everyone was doing it. Microsoft had to do it because they have the OS. The hardware makers had to do it because they had to support those computers with businesses, and businesses expect certain things to work. You know, when you look at Skylake and you look at the kind of the unique stuff that's going on there, USB 3.1, Thunderbolt... there's a lot of neat stuff that's in there. It doesn't necessarily make a lot of sense to backport that stuff except in very basic form to Windows 7, right? There's not going to be a bunch of people with USB-C based computers running around plugging in USB-C cables and docks and stuff and you know, and running Windows 7. I mean, it just doesn't it doesn't make a lot of sense. It's sort of like buying a Ferrari and putting a Volkswagen Beetle engine into it, and you know, because you know that's we standardized on Volkswagen Beetle 12 years ago. That's what we do. We're a slow moving enterprise. But that's what enterprises are doing when they buy a brand new computer with brand new hardware, and then they jam it back to some ancient version of Windows. And by the way, let's not forget Windows 7, glorified service pack to Windows Vista. Windows Vista development began in 2001. This thing is more than 10 years old. Architecturally. I mean, so Microsoft's, you know, probably not going to trash their own OS, but let's face it. I mean, this thing dates back to forever ago, and I think we're reaching the point where this 10-year life cycle is starting to bite them because the pace of silicon innovation, I can't believe I just said that, it's moving pretty quickly. God help me.
Yeah. The problem, though, for businesses is a lot of them just started moving to Windows 7 not that long ago, right? So they're like, yeah, it's great the PC makers are doing all this cool stuff with new camera technology and new chips and this and that, but you know what? I need to care more about Windows 7.
We can't wait to begin enjoying it in 16 years.
Yeah.
And who knows? I mean, the net effect of this may be that businesses start to move along a little more quickly than they did in the past. I don't know. I mean, I guess the alternative would be you walk away, but I'm really curious to see how this happens. Or I guess the alternative would be PC makers start offering older chipsets and extend the life of certain model lines.
Oh, that's interesting.
Just to, you know, be able to supply their businesses with these systems that run Windows 7.
Yeah, we haven't heard the other shoe drop. Maybe Intel has a response to this.
Yeah, maybe.
Yeah.
I was going to say, Microsoft gives OEMs a date when they can no longer preload a certain version of an operating system on new PCs, right? On new machines of any kind, not just Skylake, but on any.
But that doesn't prevent an enterprise from downgrading.
No.
You're still licensed to downgrade, so you can still do it yourself.
Yeah.
What is that date for Windows 7, by the way? Is that what you're
October 31st this year.
Oh, Windows yikes. 7.
Yep.
We gotta have more conversations with
Halloween
these people.
Because there are so many
unanswered questions here.
Yeah. There are.
It really is a huge topic. It's amazing how big of a topic this is.
You know, my suspicion is, when you read this, the implication is, oh, goodness, I'm going to buy, let's not use Skylake because that's kind of in the middle, but I'm going to buy the next generation, Kaby Lake.
Yeah.
And I'm going to buy a Kaby Lake machine, and I would love to run Windows 7, and it's going to say, sorry, there'll be a pop-up that says, sorry, you can't install Windows 7 on Kaby Lake. That's the worst-case scenario that everybody's imagining. It might
be. Do you think that's what it is?
No. I think what'll happen is you'll install Windows 7, and it'll install, and it'll run.
Yes, but what about updates?
And you just won't get updates, or some issues, and you'll need a third-party driver for something.
Yeah, but businesses won't go. If they don't get security updates, businesses won't go.
I mean, and by the way, that itself is an unprecedented situation.
If Microsoft does that, that's, to me, anti-competitive. That's not a requirement. That's them saying you got to have to upgrade. Sorry, you got to use it. If it's Thunderbolt doesn't work because I have Kaby Lake and Windows 7 never heard of Thunderbolt. Yeah. We've seen this before. Remember, USB didn't work on Windows 95. Yeah. But there were third, so the OEM will put in a driver that'll make it work. And if that may be all Microsoft's saying is, you know, we're not going to make sure Thunderbolt works on Windows 7.
That's what I'm wondering. In other words, if you look at the Kaby Lake, whatever that's called, and that part of the discussion in the blog post, it's not entirely clear if they're going to not support it. I mean, in other words, they're not going to support new hardware features in that platform. I think we all can all agree that's fine. The question is whether they support, you know, the most critical security updates was a hilarious new name, or critical updates, which now are not so critical, apparently. That is unprecedented. I hope that's not what that means. I guess it's okay to say it that way.
I feel I feel like that would be actionable. That would be using your market position to push people to spend. Well, they can't say spend money, and maybe this is how they get. This is why Microsoft can say this now.
Yeah.
But that would push people to do the new Windows 10, which is in Microsoft's economic interest, whether or not you pay for it. So if it's some artificial constraint, like, well, we just don't want to support it because we want you to use Windows 10, then maybe that's but annoying.
In direct terms of revenue, it actually doesn't matter which version of Windows you use.
You're buying
a Windows license, you're going to get Windows 10, or you can down. I don't know, but I mean, you could downgrade it to 7. It doesn't matter to them, you know. I don't think that impacts them. But there is a very real cost associated with support. There's a very real cost associated with retrofitting an older version of Windows to run new technology, to work effectively on new silicon, or however you want to say it. Microsoft is a humongous company. We know this. But they don't have infinite resources. And you have to wonder if, you know, in their push to go forward with Windows 10, add new features, make it better and better every day, whatever, you know, how much support can they give to older versions of Windows? I mean, you know, Windows 7 hasn't gotten a new feature since Windows 7 was first released. Not really. I mean, they're not putting a lot of effort into this. I mean, I'm sure that the security update situation on Windows 7 is as minimal as it has to be just to keep those things secure. Are we going to ask Microsoft to pull off half the people on Windows 10 and just to make sure that these old versions of Windows are always up to date? I mean, is that the goal? Would you do that? If you, you know, if you could run Microsoft for a day, would that make sense? Would that be your decision?
I guess it kind of, from an economic point, their economic point of view, it does make sense that you don't want to devote resources to a 10-year-old operating system.
But especially on brand new hardware that, you know, it by all rights, it is really that it's Volkswagen engine Ferrari thing. I mean, it's like,
it's mostly okay, enterprise. I guess. Really, this is really mostly an enterprise issue.
Yes,
end users.
Absolutely. Yeah.
If I'm a gamer and I say, oh, I got to get Cabby Lake for the Thunderbolt or Skylake for the Thunderbolt, as you said at the very beginning of this, Paul, it's a very small number of people who would say, oh, and then I'm going to put Windows 7 on it.
Yeah.
right. I just spent $3,200 on this computer. I can't wait to put Windows 7 on it.
I think it's really about businesses that don't want to do this.
Yeah.
And Mary Jo, they're making some concessions for that situation.
I mean, they're giving them till 2017 and saying things are going to work on this list of hardware, which we don't have a complete list of yet, but... we're going to have Paul's heard quite a few different machines on that list, and if you buy something on that list, you'll have that concession till 2017. The question for us is, what happens after 2017? That's kind of like the unknown right now.
Yes, and in more ways than one, because we also have these questions about these new processor generations coming down the line, and whether or not they'll be supported on older versions of Windows in any way, shape, or form. And I guess, you know, maybe by next week we'll know the answer to that one. This is certainly an ongoing drama, no doubt about it.
it's really interesting. And maybe now I can say it's not as bad as it looked.
Yeah. And actually, that's the most interesting thing about this, because and that's true of many things, right? The dust settles and you kind of can look at it a little more clearly. You know, but look, like I said, they're still arriving at the same place.
Yeah.
They're really pushing Windows 10 aggressively.
Yeah, this is part of that.
Very aggressively. And now they're doing so to businesses as well. And by the way, they may have completely valid reasons. I'll give them that. The world has changed. You know, this is not Microsoft running roughshod over the whole industry. This is Microsoft standing next to the Googles and Apples and whatever.
It's not as if an enterprise can say, well, okay, then I'm running Ubuntu from now on.
You're the Linux desktop.
Microsoft,
all right, so Microsoft it controls the enterprise. I mean, you know, Apple controls the DJ market too. It's not like those guys can say, I want to go back to an older version.
No. I'm not saying it in a bad way. I'm saying it's not a risky thing for Microsoft to do this, because they could go to Mac.
Oh, I see what you're saying.
I guess they could go to Mac, but Apple does the same thing. Of course, Apple gives away the OS, so it's not as big of an issue.
Well, but it is the same thing. I mean, there is no instance of a company.
You probably can't install El Capitan.
No.
I mean, you can't install, I'm sorry, you can't install Mountain Lion.
Like Snow Leopard on
Skylake. Yeah, because it won't, it's not that it won't install, it'll install just fine. And many things won't work. And that's kind of this, what I anticipate is the same thing that would happen with Windows.
They've never tested it because they don't have to.
They don't have to.
You know?
Doesn't matter.
And that's the thing. And again, that must be wonderful for them. I think this support thing that Microsoft got into is a lot like their PC maker partnership thing, where it's the strongest part of the ecosystem. It's also the Achilles heel.
Yeah.
And, you know, there's good and bad to this kind of thing. And so this type of thing has gotten Microsoft so this far, but man, does this have to change. And I think that's, you know, sometimes you got to take the hard hit, and maybe that's what they're doing here, but man, it
they
does not help
this
the way.
Better. They really
they could have communicated this is, and how many times do we say that?
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
That if you get through the, you know, the story and kind of figure out what's really going on, and you're like, look, they said this, but this is what it really means. You have to always kind of wonder. I wonder after every one of these things, you know, this could have been explained better.
And if Windows 10 is the last version of Windows, it's not going to ever have to be explained again.
Well,
right?
Well, not exactly, because there's still going to be like a life cycle type of thing. I mean, as Windows 10 moves forward,
is there a life cycle if you don't ever get up do a new version?
Yeah, there is. I mean, I think at some point, you know.
Well, here's what I anticipate.
Yeah,
it's just you. There's Windows. You install Windows. You don't think about.
Listen,
Windows.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
It installs, and when you get new hardware, you install Windows. You don't,
Except,
you just install Windows.
Right. So Mary Jo knows more about this than I do, but there is a long-term servicing option for enterprises, and that's the real life cycle of this thing. In other words, the RTM version of Windows 10 that shipped on July 29th, businesses can run that thing. Do you happen to know until when? And for a long time.
CSB. Long-term servicing branch?
Yeah.
Wow, I should know that right off the top of my head, but I
don't. Yeah, I'm surprised you don't. Yeah, you know, it's disappointing, Mary Jo. No, but it's a long time.
To me, the real date, well, the date on Microsoft's lifecycle website right now that says how long is extended support for different versions, Windows 10 has a date on there of October 14th, 2025.
Right.
So that's a date that's on there. And I assume that date will keep moving as they continue to rev things like with Redstone, right?
Well, if you look, I don't know if you have that in front of you, but if you look at Windows 8, what they talk about is this kind of this notion that the minimum accepted version is Windows 8.1. And I think that's what changes, right?
Yeah, 2023,
Yeah, but it's not, so in other words, Windows 8 just left support, right? You can't use Windows 8.1. You have to have Windows 8.1 now to get support. And I think for Windows 10, it's going to be the same thing. Eventually, it changes to 15.11. Right. And then eventually it will change to Redstone or whatever's next. And eventually, you know, it goes on from there. So I guess what I'm saying is for businesses that are on this long term support channel, they have much more time, like years more to run the original version of Windows 10 than anyone else, including other business types. And I think they represent the
true cutoff date. Right.
Yeah. Right. Right. I think that's the way I would poorly explain it, I guess.
All right. Anything
ten
more to
years.
Say?
Yeah, LTSB was 10 years, and that started counting, I guess, immediately after published by Microsoft. So that, again, that may be
that's
a rolling date.
That's the 10 years. So technically, not for everybody, but for those, you know, the creme de la creme of the enterprise, if for some reason, I don't know why they would do it, but they could run the July 29 version of Windows 10 for 10 years? Really? 10 years?
10 years.
That's crazy. They really should never have done that.
Unless new hardware comes out.
Yeah, they will
unless new hardware comes out. That's right. There you go. There's the asterisk.
They get a push. They get an update push every year or 2 years, I think. But it's a total bare minimum because this is the version of Windows 10 they want you to run in like embedded.
It's no new features. In other words, it's just the security update kind of thing.
Yeah, but just, nope, I think just maybe that's the most critical. I don't know.
The worst part of that would be running that original version of the Mail app.
Oh, no. I don't think it counts
the app. I actually guess the Mail app gets upgraded.
Agree, though, on that.
Yeah. Oh, it's just, you know, we should, I really need to have a more positive outlook on life. I should just be thankful when this stuff happens. This is like job security. You know, it really, it is amazing. You know, just when you think it can't get any sillier,
yeah.
Friday happens, you know?
Oh, man.
I was out of sorts for hours.
How would you, how would you say this better?
How would I say this better?
If you were, put yourself in Microsoft's shoes. Actually, let me ask Mary Jo, because you know how to address the enterprise. Paul, okay. I know what Paul's going to do.
No, you know what I would have done? If I were Microsoft and this, I wanted to make this announcement, I would have done an announcement that said, the headline probably wouldn't have been anything about silicon. It would have been
That's a
Windows
good start.
Support changes and how they will affect you.
There you go.
And then I would have laid out some timelines, some nice diagrams perhaps with changes in downgrade rights, and maybe had a little FAQ in there saying, hey, what if I'm doing X? What will happen to my dates? I think that's how I would have approached it.
Right. You basically, look, something bad has happened.
Yeah.
Here's the problem.
Right.
Here's how we're going to fix it.
Right.
Here's what it means to you. It's a lot of why. And then this is what we're going to do in response. You know, in other words, we're not just randomly being evil, you know.
No.
This is, look, this was driven by some need.
Yeah. The trick is, if you're Microsoft, you're balancing a lot of things here. Like,
right.
We're just saying in an ideal world, they would just approach the customer situation and explain it and say, you know, it's not great that we have to do this, but we do. But they're trying to juggle, like, the PC makers and Intel and AMD and, right. like, keep everybody happy, right? Because they are, it's like a very interdependent ecosystem that Windows is part of. So they can't just go out there and go, let's throw so-and-so under the bus here and just say it's all their fault, right? So I think it's a little more nuanced and tricky than I'm just laying it out there as, but yeah.
Oh yeah, no, yeah, right. I should say, don't take this wrong. I mean, it's not like you read through this and think, you know, these idiots, this is so easily explained.
No. No, it's not.
It really does need to be explained properly. The problem is it feels deceptive when it's like rah rah rah. Windows 10 is awesome on new hardware. You know, like guys, you know, the new version of Windows is always best on new hardware. Everyone understands that. This has nothing to do with Windows.
They could have left that part out.
You know,
I would have started really, with this paragraph.
Yeah.
No, right. I would have started with this.
Cut to the chase.
Windows 7 was designed nearly 10 years ago. Before any x86 or x64 system on a chip existed. Windows 7, this is the thing that I think is buried that people need to understand. For Windows 7 to run on any modern silicon, device drivers and firmware need to emulate Windows 7's expectations for interrupt processing, bus support, and power states, which is challenging for modern processors. As partners make customizations to legacy device driver services and firmware settings, customers are likely to see regressions. I don't even know what that means, but that I would leave that sentence out. But but the point being, what you may not know is it's a lot of work to keep old versions of Windows working on brand new hardware.
And at some point, it just stops to make sense.
And at some point, it doesn't make any sense. I think that's if you say it that way, people go, oh, okay. And then you say, and so here's what we're going to do for end of life for old operating systems on new hardware. Yep. And then I think you say something, now because we know you doofuses in enterprise like to run old operating systems on brand new hardware for reasons we'll never fully understand.
Budgetary reasons.
For budget, sometimes. No. And training, and I understand. Sure. No, I understand. Sure. This is what we're going to do for you.
Yeah.
Which isn't much, but at least it's something. We're going to give you 18 months to figure this out, basically, right? That's kind of what they said, Mary Jo. We'll give you 18 months.
Yep.
Yeah.
We could pull the plug now, but we're going to give you 18
months. Giving you 18 months.
I think what they should have said is for people on our enterprise support contracts, we're going to support this to the end of life of those operating systems, because that's what we said we would do. Not end of, is it? What if they just did it to end of mainstream support?
Oh, that's already expired.
That's done. Already expired. It's, yeah.
Well, then this isn't such a big deal. They should just say, that's part of mainstream support. But we're going to do you a favor. We'll give you an extra 18. We're going to extend mainstream support.
In other words, right. So if you were going to add Thunderbolt support to Windows 7, you could make an argument that's a new feature. That's something we do during mainstream support.
Right.
It's not something we do during.
And you know what? Mainstream support's already over for
Windows 7.
So yeah, good news. Here's the good news.
By the way, that
would have been good news.
I mean, that type of thing, a PC maker could add that functionality too.
And they will, by the way, because PC makers want to sell new hardware. And they want to sell new hardware to the dopes who want to run Windows 7.
Right. Like Microsoft, they actually don't care which version of Windows you want.
They couldn't care less.
Yeah. Yeah. That's true.
I mean, isn't it the case OEMs always offer the old version of Windows a lot longer than Microsoft wants? And they finally, that's what the Halloween cutoff always is.
Well, listen, they're the ones directly interacting with the customers. They know what they want. They know what people want. I mean, they're asking for Windows 7 right now. That's what they want. They were asking for Windows XP for a long time.
So I know Chris Capicella listens. I just wrote your press release for you.
There you go.
You know why these then end up being, and listen to all our customers and how much they love the new hardware. And by the way, this is embracing silicon innovation.
Yep.
That's what was really confusing, I think. And you had to really parse it, as always, to figure out what it meant.
Yeah, and I just feel like reiterating how awesome Windows 10 is with new hardware was completely unnecessary to the point of this. You talk about that separately. We've talked about that a lot already. You can mention it in passing because, right, to me, the story is Windows 7, Windows 8.1. Mostly Windows 7 because, I don't think many businesses
would ask. They should go to Tom Warren and Ed Bott and people like that and say, look, here's how you write this story. Not sure they try. And then he goes, up your nose with a rubber hose. But this is how you write the story. Windows 7 mainstream support is over. But, by the way, mainstream support doesn't just include, fixing mail. It also includes system on a chip drivers and motherboard drivers for new silicon. And we can't keep updating that. So, we're going to roll that into mainstream support. And by the way, because we know you enterprise users care, we'll give you an extra 18 months.
So Windows 8 has to still be in mainstream support, right? It's only 3.5 years old.
Not much longer. Sorry. No. I think, what is it, Mary Jo?
8.1.
Well, 8.1.
8 is done. 8.1 is just 2 more years, I think.
Well, is it July 2017? I mean, maybe that has something to do with that data.
It's 2018, right? Because its extended support date is 2023.
Right. So it's 2 more years plus 5 years for extended support. Does this, and extended support is critical, is security updates. And that they did kind of blow. They really need to continue with this.
Well, it's not clear.
And they are continuing with some. This, a very major critical blah, 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 which is, it would be nice to know what that means. Does it mean?
I think they should have just said.
I don't think they can say.
Maybe they don't know.
I think the issue is there's going to be some thing that comes up 2 years from now on Skylake that's security related. And what they're going to discover is that if they fix this on certain configurations, something else stops working or whatever it is. I'm sure they're. Look, they're not stupid people. I mean,
obviously
they're
often deliberately
vague in some cases because they're not.
You sound like Donald Trump for a moment. They're losers. They're stupid, stupid people.
Listen, stupid. This is how you fix Windows.
I'm a genius.
I know. How are we telling
I'm going to get Apple to make all this stuff over here again.
Yeah. Why are we even saying
But that? If we frame it that mainstream support is over, it's going to be over, interestingly enough, around July 20. 18.
Honestly, they could end mainstream support for Windows 8.1 for businesses today, and I don't think
nobody uses it. Nobody's going to complain.
I don't think there would be too much of a pushback on that.
Isn't this about Windows 7? Is it about XP a little bit? But XP?
No, XP's gone. XP's gone.
Nobody could possibly expect support for that. So it's about Windows 7.
This is almost entirely about 7. Yeah. This blog post.
Yep. So much so that they should just roll Windows 8.1 support into Windows 7. So just say it's the same thing. I because really this support's about businesses. They're not adding new features to Windows 8.1 now. Who cares? If you're running Windows 8.1, you're getting fixes. That's all you're getting every month. So,
I wonder if anybody's running Windows 8.1.
In businesses, there are some.
Are they?
There are some. There are not a lot.
It's got to be some.
If you look at the market share numbers, it's always like Windows 7, giant, like more than 50%, right? I actually got some interesting tweets from Wes Miller, who's at Directions on Microsoft, when this came out Friday, because I said to him, wow, what do you make of this? Because he's a licensing specialist, right? And he just very succinctly to me said what this was about. He said, you know what they should say? For some time, what was a good PC before Windows 10 arrived and what's a good PC now have been diverging. And right. Now we're in a world of tightly engineered hardware and software. I'm like, yep, that's the whole beginning of that blog post, right? Mm. It's like the chips mm-hmm. and the operating system are being designed hand in hand. And so running yeah. an older operating system on something that has all these new features that you couldn't account for when you built this operating system, that just doesn't make sense anymore.
There's also examples of PCs that are being built hand in hand between the PC maker and Microsoft, you know, and obviously on Surface yeah. within Microsoft, where right. These things are designed very specifically to work really well together. You buy an NVX or Spectre X360 or a Dell XPS 13 or whatever. You're going to put Windows 7 on that kind of computer? I mean, seriously? Right. It's crazy. You know, if you have to run Windows 7 for some reason, you don't put it on that computer. You put it on a, you know, just a standard laptop.
That's a good point. Yeah. If you're Dell, just keep selling. Hey, we got these Core 2 Duos on sale.
Yeah, enjoy. Exactly.
Windows 7 runs just as well as it always did yep. on the Core 2.
Enjoy your 2 gigs of RAM and your
actually that's 93 an interesting
megahertz
thought.
RAM. Yeah,
that might be one way OEMs could respond to this. You know, if you're running a 56 Buick, you're not going to put a 2016 carburetor in it.
Although I did have an uncle who built engines for a living, and he put Volvo engines into a Mercury boat.
That's sacrilege.
I know, but
raconteur.
He knew how to fix it.
Thank you very much. You know, I had an uncle once. All right, let's take a break because we got happier things to talk about. And, yeah. But
and some unhappy, but mostly happy.
Oh, crap. Trying to cheer everybody up. Our show today brought to you by our good buds at audible.com. I know Paul, not Mary Jo. Mary Jo, why don't you listen to audiobooks?
You know what? If I commuted, that's I think problem. I would.
Your commute's too short.
I work at home. And I don't drive.
You listen to 5 seconds of a book each day.
I know.
Okay, that's a good point. Although, if you go to the gym.
I could do it like on the treadmill and
I
stuff.
Do, oh, man, it makes a treadmill so much better. Because frankly, exercise is, there's nothing fun about exercising. It's boring, which is good for you, but it's boring. But listening to a book, you know, the Audible ads that they've been running on Downton Abbey, I guess they're a sponsor of Downton Abbey, are great because it's somebody like some guy eating cereal with his headphones on, and then they pan back and it turns out he's in a 17th century you know, Castle Marie Antoinette, and they're at their dinner table, and it's like the stories surround you, and it's really true. Yeah. It takes you out of your, let's face it, mundane, drab existence, and puts you on the Mars, puts you in new worlds, and it expands your mind, and it's fun, and we just love it, and that's why I always tell everybody who listens to our shows, hie thee to audible.com/windows, and get yourself your first book free, because if you get this Robert Gates book, scathing book, is well worth reading. So there's a lot of contemporary stuff, you know, current events stuff, and then we know a lot of you like science fiction. The Audible Frontiers program brings some of the best science fiction to life, even classics like this Robert Heinlein novel that came out in gosh knows when 19 I don't know what. What they're doing is they're taking books that never were out on audio and recording them in their studios and giving you, by the way, great readers that make it like you're there. It's better. It's a movie in your mind. Get your first one free. Audible.com/windows. What'll happen here is you're signing up for the gold account. That's one book a month subscription. That is a subscription is the most affordable way to do this. It's a great way. That's what I do. Plus, you get the Daily Digest of the New York Times and the Wall Street Journal. If you cancel in the first 30 days, you'll pay nothing. But that book will be yours to keep. Oh, there's a new Bill Bryson out. Oh, I love Bill Bryson. The Road to Little Dribbling. I love the name. Adventures of an American in Britain. Oh, he's gone back to that. That's great. The Mother Tongue, if you've never read that. What are you listening to these days, Paul?
I'm going back and forth between a number of books. I think one I haven't mentioned is a little indie film came out last month called Star Wars, The Force Awakens. You might have heard of it.
Yeah.
I'm kind of a Star Wars geek. I mean, obviously, I grew up in the 70s, so Star Wars was life-changing for me. And, you know, I talk to people who've seen the movie multiple times, and the reason they go back again and again is because it's what they did when they was a kid, and they're trying to pretend that this movie is as good as the original Star Wars. But, what they really want to do is learn more about the story, and they feel like they, get a little bit more out of it each time. And I tell them all the same thing. If you want to learn more about this story, you got to read the book.
Yeah.
There's a lot more information in the book, a lot more information. It's actually a really good story. The audiobook is really interesting because it's one of those performance type things. So it's not a multi-cast deal, but it's a single person. But there's music and the sound effects, and it's actually pretty well done.
Fired weapon, staring despite himself. And in response, the figure of Kylo Ren turned and looked sideways directly at the soldier.
Okay, you get the idea. Yep. It's great. Good. I got chills. Yeah. Star Wars The Force Awakens, that could be your first one. All you got to do is go to audible.com/windows, get your first book free. But I should warn you, it's addictive. And I've been a member for 16 years now. And I listen all the time. Lisa and I both do. And now that we have Amazon Echoes, we have dueling echoes. Sometimes she's listening in the bedroom, I'm listening in the kitchen. It's great. audible.com/windows. Somebody said the ultimate spoiler in the novel is not in the movie.
The ultimate spoiler
in the novel.
And did they say what that spoiler is?
Well, no. Because
so what
that
I thought,
would be
so
a spoiler.
I think we're at the point now where if you were
we are not. Oh, no, no, my friend.
Okay. So I will just say I read the book before I saw the movie. The book came out on the same day as the movie.
Oh, you are a devoted fan.
So I read it first. And when I was a kid, when the Empire, I'll tell you another story. When the Empire Strikes Back came out, when I was a kid, I read the book first, same thing. And when I was done, my dad said, how was the book? And I said, it was great. But I said, I think they left off the ending. So you'd go see the movie. I didn't understand the notion of a cliffhanger.
Ah.
I just couldn't believe they would end the story midstream, like that. And, with this book, it's a different experience. Obviously I'm like 50 years old now, but there's so much more information in the book that when I saw the movie, I was like, what are they doing? Like they really chop up the dialogue. There's entire expositions that are just missing. And I have to think, like, if you just watch the movie, you wouldn't actually understand a lot of what was going on.
I got to get the book now.
I was really confused by the
it's a novelization, though, right? The book came out after the movie. It was not like some guy wrote the book and then they made a movie out of it.
That's true. Maybe. No, you're right. But if you think of working off of a script or whatever, they did it. By the way, I should say the author of this book is Alan Dean Foster. He actually wrote the original Star Wars book. It was credited to George Lucas, but he was the author.
Okay.
Actually, they just put George Lucas's name on it.
Okay.
I don't know if he was involved with the script. I don't think so, but I'm sure they worked off the same script. I'm sure when they actually make the movie, what they have to do is edit it and cut it, and whether or not they filmed every single scene in the book or whatever, I don't know. But and then cut some of it out. Who can say? But there's so much more information in this book than
you
is in the.
You just convinced me. I have put it in my wish list. It'll be in my shopping cart next month.
It's a good one. It's a good one.
When I get my credit. audible.com/whatever. Windows. You better say Windows, because if you don't, then Paul and Mary Jo don't get credit. It's not like we pay them based on the number of hits or anything. They don't pay us on the number of hits, but it's good for them to know. People are listening to that Windows Weekly show. Who would have thunk it? By the way, maybe I shouldn't tell you this. Never mind.
Hmm? What? No, what? Come on.
Never mind.
No, you can't do that.
This is our number three show. There's This Week in Tech, new screensavers, which soared to the top of the charts very quickly, and Windows Weekly. But Windows Weekly and Security Now and MacBreak Weekly kind of go back and forth. But I think right now you're number one.
I will destroy them. Those stupid guys on those other podcasts.
Kylo Thurrott, ladies and gentlemen. Okay. All righty. I'm going to download that one. It sounds really, really good. Moving along, there are other stories. I think you had this story, Mary Jo. We're starting to learn more about the HoloLens. In fact, one of the HoloLens guys was speaking. Wasn't he in Scotland or somewhere and told us some stuff?
Yeah, Brad Sams actually found this video.
Brad, that's where I saw it. Brad Sams.
Yeah.
And by the way, he predicted in his article on Petri that Microsoft would soon block it. So watch the video. And by the time I got there, it was blocked.
Yep. So. But Tom Warren saved it too, and he posted it back up to YouTube.
Man.
Yeah.
Okay. Not us, Chris Capicella. Somebody else. But.
So there is a guy, and I'll tell you, I'll be a rack hunter now.
Please.
This guy named Bruce Harris, who is a technical evangelist for Microsoft, went to Tel Aviv, and he was presenting, I believe it was an NDA session on the HoloLens. Somebody who was there took video of it and posted it to YouTube.
So it wasn't official.
Right. So I looked up this guy, and I don't know if his LinkedIn profile is real, but he looks like he may have been fired because of this.
right.
Oh.
He doesn't work at Microsoft anymore.
Oh, man. That's not his fault that somebody broke the NDA.
Yeah. Well, the problem was in this video, he spoke very freely. And not only did he talk about the HoloLens battery life, which he said ranged between 2.5 and 5.5 hours. And the 2.5 was for intensive tasks. The 5 was more, he said something like, for like browsing your email using the HoloLens. I was like, wow.
As one
do that. Yep. But unfortunately, in this presentation, he also really badmouthed Microsoft marketing and made fun of them. And all of that was in the video.
That's what he got fired for.
Not that is awesome.
Okay, that's what he got fired.
Yeah. All right. So it wasn't the best. I actually feel for the guy, but he probably should have figured somebody in the audience might have captured that. He kept saying, like, I hope no one's blogging this or writing this down. And I was like, yeah, somebody was. But yeah, anyway, so he talked about the battery life, which surprised some people, I think, because they were like, only 2.5 hours? Wait a second. I saw a couple people, though, mention, would you want this big thing on your head for more than 2.5 hours?
Yeah.
You know, it's heavy. Yeah.
Yep. The thing I thought that was most interesting that he said was that the reason it was a small display was for battery life and CPU purposes, and that there was no reason they couldn't make it bigger, except you wouldn't want to wear it. And,
and the cost.
And cost.
Also the cost.
So I thought that was very encouraging, that they had a vision of going forward as, you know, technology improves, of making it a more...
But will they support Windows 7 on the new HoloLens?
No.
Good question.
Yeah, so I thought that was good. In fact, I was glad to get these tidbits. I thought these were very helpful.
Yeah. He was very forthright about the field of vision thing, like you just said. He said, you know, if you want to think what the field of vision right now is like, it's like having a 15-inch laptop 2 feet from your face, and think of the size of the screen, and that's your field of view.
Yeah.
Right
that,
now.
That... But it's small.
That's generous, actually, but yeah, okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then he also talked about the fact that it's an untethered device. It will be connectable by Wi-Fi or Bluetooth to other peripherals and other things, which is kind of an interesting scenario, too. And he also talked about device link, which is linking two HoloLenses together through a server so that you can be not even in the same room and experiencing the same thing.
Love that.
Yeah, that's pretty cool.
Love that idea.
So probably none of that was supposed to be out yet. And now it all is.
Yep.
Or you think it could have been a plan leak.
Yeah. And
maybe,
he got fired.
He's like, hey, Bob, it's your last day. You want to help us out here?
And I think get on video. What was unplanned was his bad-mouthing marketing. That's never a good idea. If you're out there talking about the company, representing the company, you'd say nice things about the company.
Yeah. I mean, I think he was trying to do like a little camaraderie, like, yeah, you know those marketing guys, but yeah.
It could have been an Israeli cultural thing as well. They tend to be very forthright, and maybe that's part of it. You know.
Was he working in Israel, not in Redmond?
No, I don't think so. I think he was working, if this is the same guy, Washington,
he's just a jerk. Sorry.
Washington, D.C., if this, again, if this is his real profile and all, the other funny thing or interesting thing, if this is his real profile, is he wrote that he used to work in the CIA.
Oh, it's maybe on his profile as well. Maybe it's a joke.
Maybe
not. He works if he's in D.C. Maybe not.
Yeah.
Hmm.
It says now retired and enjoying time to pursue my personal interests and family as his latest. If, again, this is him.
Well, I think for one, I'm glad to get this information. I think it's encouraging.
Yeah. Yep.
It kind of explains, this is the first person from Microsoft to say anything about the field of view, which is kind of sad. Mm-hmm. And the last, I think.
Oh, has the field of view been in a story associated with HoloLens? I don't remember that. Yeah.
But yeah. It means that they can do more. But it's what we thought, which is you're limited by cost, primarily, cost.
It's V1. You know, things are going to get better.
Cost, battery, the size of the glass, right? Isn't that something else?
And that would explain why the first demo you guys had, which was a tethered unit, was mm-hmm. bigger. Mm-hmm. Wasn't battery powered. And cost was no object.
True.
Right?
Okay.
Am I going to have to return my power cable? This is Surface Pros, not Surface Books, right?
Right.
Oh. It doesn't impact Surface Book.
Isn't it the same? No. I thought it was the same, though.
Well, it also doesn't impact Surface Pro 4.
So they fixed
it. Although, by the way, even though they look the same, actually the Surface Book power supply is slightly bigger than the one you get with Surface Pro 4.
Yeah, somebody told me because I was using, I think Bruce has a Surface Pro 3 or 4, but I was using his, the connector is physically the same.
It works. It just,
it's slow.
It's slower. That's right.
It's not as high wattage.
That's right.
Yeah.
So this is a voluntary recall Microsoft's doing. Probably going to have the page up later this week for this, for the power supplies for Surface Pro, Pro 2, Pro 3. And they are saying the AC power cords being too tightly wound around it or end up pinching it, and then it's a fire hazard, basically.
Oh, I see.
And by the way,
it's going to be a voluntary worldwide recall, and they're going to replace it for free.
Okay.
And to be clear, it's the cord. It's only that little part at the end. It's not the box
with the
thing.
It's the brick, I believe.
No, it's not the brick.
It's everything but the brick.
No, it's just the cable. That's what they told me.
Okay.
Yeah, because
they didn't tell me when I asked. Yeah.
They contacted me because they said, you know, the wording that you're using here, I think that some people are going to think that we're replacing the whole thing and we're just replacing the cord. It's not the brick.
Okay.
Yeah. So I in other words, the expectation is you're going to get this new unit in the mail or something, and what you're going to get is a 6-inch, whatever the thing. I don't know if I have one around it somewhere.
Just the cable part.
The end part.
Hey, I just wanted to, speaking of the Surface Book, mention that I've now, because I have two Windows 10 machines, I put Linux Mint on my Dell, and it runs great. By the way,
you should throw Windows 7 on there and see if it works.
Works better. Linux Mint. All the drivers work. The camera works. Everything works. It all works. Straight out of the box. In the touch, even
Thunderbolt,
works.
USB-C.
I haven't tried Thunderbolt. I'm sure it does. The touch works, which is kind of cool.
What is this machine?
It's my old Dell XPS 13.
Yeah.
I mean, it's kind of cool that I can...
You know, every time you use Linux on a touch machine, a unicorn dies, right? You know that.
No.
What about a Ninja Cat?
At least as well as desktop Windows. It works pretty nicely. It's really... Shut your mouth. I'm talking about Linux Mint. It has a
PC does
a start
what?
Menu. Yeah, really. I should do a PC does what ad. PC runs Linux? What? What the what? It's awesome. That's when I know this is the wrong show to flog this on.
You're killing me.
You are. Don't show Linux on this show.
It runs nicely.
You're like, it's not just getting stabbed in the back. You've like broken off the tip and now it's making its way to my heart.
It's only because I have a Surface Book and it was getting, you know, like, why do I got two touch Windows 10 devices sitting next to each other. I don't really need
that anymore. I have no problem with everything you've said so far. So why did you change it?
Actually, mostly I was curious because, you know, I do this, you know, every 6 months or so. How's desktop Linux these days?
Yep.
I'm pleased to say it is making progress. And I probably...
Maybe this is the year.
It always is.
You know, with Microsoft just dramatically changing their enterprise support for Windows, I mean, you never know.
Everyone's going Linux.
I'll be honest. It was after that announcement, in a fit of pique. Well, screw that.
I think we all experienced a fit of pique over the past 72 hours or whatever that is. Yes. I guess it's been more than that, but whatever.
Seems running quite well, and I'm using the Cinnamon I want to
cinnamon mint.
Cinnamon mint, yes. I wanted to see what the, because the real issue I've always had with Linux on the desktop is it just doesn't, you know, it looks kind of funky. This actually looks really good. The fonts look good. Everything
I
looks
I don't mind
nice.
The way Linux looks. It's just the applications and.
Well, you know, I use Chrome a lot. And as soon as you install Chrome, which probably is. Yep. Richard Stallman would frown, but as soon as you saw Chrome, it syncs up.
For me, it's Photoshop, it's Office.
Right, you don't want to use the GIMP.
I can't get my
or Abbey Word.
Abbey Word, yeah, I'm going to jump back to
LibreOffice. anyway, moving on. Sorry to derail. Surface 3 bundle is a little bit less expensive if you're in education. That's good news. Yeah.
This one's kind of interesting, although the wording of the blog post was a little confusing. Microsoft's going to offer educational discounts for Surface 3, which is not the Pro, the one they came out with last summer. And it's going to be up to 30% off, but the actual price depends on which authorized device reseller you go through. I've been trying to find out if this is a worldwide deal or just in the UK, but I can't find that out yet. I've been trying for a couple days. And it says in the blog post, as of February 1st, these will also ship with the new Surface Pro 4 Pen, but it doesn't say free. So I'm not sure if that's part of the bundle price or not. But if you're in education, there is a Microsoft blog post. It lists a number of, I believe, all UK resellers and says contact them for the details.
Okay. Good deal.
Yep.
And this must be a Paul Thurrott story. The Dell Venue 8 Pro.
Yeah. Well, you know, back in the Windows 8, well, I guess 8.1 time frame, there was exactly one really good mini tablet that was also affordable, which is the Dell Venue 8 Pro. It was fantastic. It was really inexpensive. It was about $300. And as we move forward to, you know, Windows 10, the mini tablet thing has kind of dropped off the face of the earth. You know, we had HP Stream 7 and 8s. We had the Dell I just talked about. We had the ThinkPad that kind of came and went and then came back again. And, you know, what's going on with mini tablets? And you know, I don't really know. Maybe they're not the hot category they used to be. But the one major release we've seen is the HP Envy Note, which is an 8-inch device, beautiful aluminum, you know, nicely made. Plugs into a big keyboard, like a full-size laptop type keyboard. That's kind of a neat thing. But then this week, it surprised me, but they announced a new version of the Dell Venue 8 Pro. So a little more expensive. It's around $400 now, which is the same, basically the same price as the HP. But this one's kind of loaded. It's like 4 gigs of RAM, not two. A high-end Intel Atom, you know, the 7-level processor. 1080p graphics, USB-C connectivity. I mean, it looks pretty cool. I ordered one just to kind of check it out because I really am curious about what the Windows 10 experience is like on a mini tablet, and I want to try it on new hardware. And this is really the first one I've seen where it's like, yeah, okay, this might, you know, this could be it. So I'll write about it whenever it ships, but it might not be till sometime in February. They just kind of put it up on their site quietly with no, you know, PR at all, and here it comes.
Mm, nice.
Yeah.
You still using the Surface Book?
Yeah. Well, define using a Surface Book because I just canceled a trip, so I wasn't going to take it on that trip. But right now, Surface Book is in some kind of hell for me. I mean, it's a beautiful machine, but you know, it doesn't come on a lot.
Yeah.
I think it's related to this, you know, all this firmware stuff we've been talking about. I'm hoping that they fix this thing. I heard a rumor we were going to get firmware fixes this week. We didn't get any. And we'll see what happens to that. But yeah, assuming they fix everything, I mean, this is the machine I probably would use. But, you know, I have a Spectre X360 that I love, which is, you know, probably what I would have brought on the trip just because it works, you know, unlike Surface Book.
So your HP is your fave?
Yeah, I mean, I have a few that are up there. But yeah, the Spectre X360, the Surface Book, you know, again.
Do you like convertibles? I can't remember.
I don't really ever use a machine as a tablet, honestly.
Yeah.
So I don't mind Touch. I would love Surface Book more if it was just a laptop.
I love Touch. I am now convinced.
Touch is fine. But flipping it around, using it as a tablet, I'm never going to do that. The truth is, I'm never going to do that.
You know, there are use cases. I remember sitting on next to a salesman on a plane, and this was before, really, this was years ago. But he loved flipping his tablet around. He had one of those HP convertibles. And
sure.
Because he said, for presentations, I don't necessarily have to put on a big screen. I can do a presentation, use the stylus to illustrate. It's really a great way to sell and present. And so there's an application, I think, for something like that.
Mary Jo and I write.
Yeah.
I need a screen and a keyboard.
Yeah,
and,
you have different needs. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, no one's going
to write. I have tablets and phones. If I want to listen to music or watch a video or something, the computer's not where that stuff happens. Yeah. You know, I like that separation, too, you know, for whatever that's worth. The computer's a work device. I work on it.
And where do you play?
A tablet or a phone, depending on what we're talking about. Oh, my Xbox, right. I'm thinking about
it. Don't get him started. Not yet.
Okay, not yet. We'll get to that in a moment. Let's talk about phones. New Windows Phone news. Because I guess Mobile World Congress is in a month now.
Yeah, although, by the way, we're hearing that Microsoft might not actually have a big presence at Mobile World Congress.
Heard that last year, right? Didn't that
was? Yeah. It's almost like they're not really in the phone market.
Yeah.
So, but we did get some interesting news about Windows 10 Mobile, which it makes sense that, you know, it's ARM-based today primarily, that it would be coming to ARM64, the 64-bit version of the ARM platform. It's not surprising. That's fine. So they're moving that forward. But we also saw some information about how they're making a version of Windows 10 Mobile for x86. Now, this leads to a lot of speculation. There are a lot of people who kind of look at that and say, see, Surface Phone, Intel, we've been talking about that. That's purely speculation. This doesn't prove that at all. I mean, this could be for making, you know, small tablets or something. It doesn't have to be for phones. In fact, I have a question for you on that.
Mm-hmm. When Microsoft was building Windows 10 Mobile, whenever I wrote about it, the way I had been told was it worked on ARM or Intel. Like it already did.
Well, they always talked about it like that in the beginning, but they never ever shipped a build of it for Intel, right? This is not something anyone could ever test.
Right.
And
right.
so
we,
if you
they
think
used
about,
to say to us, it only is going to work on new tablets that aren't in the market yet. And so
tablets.
Maybe somebody has a build of it somewhere.
I'm not aware of anyone who does. You know, I do think that it makes sense to investigate x86 phones. I think that we're going to run into lots of issues there, you know, power management, especially battery life and all that kind of stuff. We've talked before in about the notion of a Surface Phone or any Intel-based phone being able to do real continuum, where you can put desktop apps on a thing, connect to a screen, a keyboard, and a mouse, and away you go. It's a real PC. It's a cool idea in theory, but it might work out to be like HoloLens in real life, where it's a 1.0 product and you know, the phone that can run the PC version of iTunes, Photoshop, and Chrome. Yeah, it gets like 2.5 hours of battery life as a phone, and you know, maybe it's not so great. And so we'll see what happens. But at least this stuff is sort of confirmed. Like the Windows 10 Mobile product line is actively moving forward to new platforms, and that's interesting. And so we'll see. Hopefully, maybe something we learn to build or whatever. But we'll see. I think we'll see over the course of this year whether that really turns into Surface Phone or any phone, or if it's just for tablets. So the other Windows 10 Mobile related story, which I have kind of buried in a bigger story, is that Microsoft revealed through some documentation on their MSDN website this week that Continuum for phones, which is that feature that lets phones, you know, blast out to a bigger display, use a keyboard and a mouse and other peripherals, today only works on high-end processors, meaning a Snapdragon 808 or 810. But they said, as long ago as maybe build, I mean, they said at some point we're going to move this down to the mid-level as well. And we saw what that means today or this week. Snapdragon 617, which I don't know is out yet on any phones, but is presumably coming soon, is a mid-level chipset. So 720p type phones. You'll be able to do Continuum off of that kind of a phone. And so it's possible that when Microsoft or other phone makers will announce devices that run on that chipset this year. And then you'll be able to do Continuum from them as well.
I have a question for you in this one, too. Remember when Microsoft announced Continuum for Windows 10 Mobile and they talked about how it wouldn't work on legacy devices? They said there was also something to do with the screen technology, right? It wasn't just because of the processor, but it was the screen, too.
Right. So, I don't remember that bit of it.
I remember them saying that, but it made me curious if these new devices also have to have some kind of a different screen technology to actually really support Continuum as well.
Right. Like maybe, okay. I don't know. I'm not really sure. Like a Qualcomm Snapdragon, whatever, right? I assume this is the mobile version of a system on a chip where it's the CPU, it's the graphics, it's whatever else, right? It's probably a bunch of different things together. Although you see something like you see on the Intel side, which is like Snapdragon, whatever the number is, with Adreno graphics, that kind of thing.
Yeah.
It's possible that only these new chipsets have the capability to have those kind of graphics, and that those kind of graphics are required to power a second screen.
Yeah.
Possibly. I'm not really sure.
Have you seen
everybody
Continuum?
Kept saying the screen technology, but I didn't know if they meant the screen on the phone or the screen on the, you know, the bigger screen device.
Yep.
Have you seen anybody using this?
Well, no one in real life would ever use this.
Okay,
this
is just curious.
It's a curiosity, right? Yeah. And so I have a couple of Continuum solutions. I have the Microsoft dock. I have a wireless dock that, I haven't even used, but it works. It works well, actually. The truth is it works. The issue, of course, is, as always with Windows or with Windows Mobile, certainly, is that they just really aren't apps that make sense to use in that form. So you can bring up like the Microsoft Office apps. They have Word, Excel, PowerPoint, and OneNote that are phone apps or universal apps that are like mobile apps. And they've been tailored so that if you have it connected to a big screen, you can run the thing full screen and it makes sense. Like it works, you know. But it's not the full-blown, you know, Word 2016 experience. It's Word Mobile, you know. And that's why I think like an Intel phone, if they could ever figure that out, would be amazing, because it will never make sense to run iTunes for Windows desktop on your phone. But if you use iTunes for whatever reason, it may make sense to have it on there, and then you connect to a bigger screen, a keyboard and a mouse, and then you run iTunes and it works because now you're docked and the phone's powered. It's not killing the battery. It's kind of an exciting.
Yeah.
Or you use remote desktop.
Right.
Or that's right. You could also do it.
Display it that way too.
But that's very specific to businesses, right? Or technical people.
Yeah.
Well, so there is an enterprise use case for Continuum?
They have the remote app, remote desktop stuff. I mean, you could technically use real 132 apps,
They're running remotely. No one has a laptop.
Can I just say that? Who doesn't have a laptop?
Well, I think there are probably a lot of people who travel with... Everyone has a phone, so you're always bringing your phone.
Yeah, but are you going to carry... If you're going to carry the Continuum gear...
Maybe you have it at work. And maybe work gives you one for home. And that if you go on a work trip or something, if you're used to working off of the phone and if you just have to make a couple of small edits to documents, no big deal on a phone. But if you really need to create content every once in a while, I think my kids use various non-Microsoft things for school, which drives me crazy. But the funny thing is, for certain things, when they have to print or whatever, that's when the computer comes on and then my printer fires up. And, you kind of come back to Windows when you need it, you know, for some reason. Content creation would be a big one, obviously, full-featured desktop apps.
And education, right, is another one where you could have... remote display.
This is
third world emerging countries where people don't all have computers.
The phone might be the only computer they ever own.
Right.
Look, we're talking about fantasy here, but there may be some future where a person can walk into an internet cafe and they have the docks and you have your phone, mm-hmm. you plug it in and now you have a big screen and you can print to their printer that's on the network and you can use a mouse and attach USB storage or whatever it is. It's a good idea. It's just that realistically today, real world, no one is doing this. Not really.
Yeah.
I mean, even if people had Windows phones, I don't think they'd be doing it.
Listen, we can imagine this. Well, let's call it utopia, for lack of a better term, of the future where everyone runs Windows mobile phones and, you know, we are all using Continuum and everything's great. Let's silently reflect on that future. How awesome that would be.
One of our listeners is asking us, and it's not in our notes, but maybe we should just mention it in passing. The rumors about Lumia 650 being the last Lumia.
Oh, the last Lumia.
The last Lumia.
Yeah.
So That came via Daniel Rubino. He said he's hearing that Microsoft's going to launch the Lumia 650 at, well, not even at an event, on February 1st, yes, with very little fanfare, right? And he said this is the last Lumia. He just said it kind of like, that's it. And the next phones are going to be Panos phones, right?
Well, we're hedging our bets. In other words,
we are, because they may or may not be called Surface Phone, right?
Right.
Well, I got a Photoshop idea for you when you write the article.
Yep.
On this.
The last Lumia. I like it.
The last Lumia. We don't need another hero.
You know, I wouldn't be surprised if this is true, because I definitely do feel like Microsoft is looking at Lumia as kind of like the former generation, the Nokia phones, the things that were in the pipeline.
It's also a brand that hasn't taken off, right? I mean,
has not taken
the
off.
Surface brand has cachet. Yeah.
Right. And Panos runs hardware now, right? And so he, I'm sure, wants to put his stamp on phones. But the other rumor we had heard was that Surface Phone may not debut till the end of 2016. So if this is the last Lumia, that's a long break between then and now, right?
Yeah, I mean, Microsoft released about 117 different Lumias last year. It'd be amazing if they just kind of gave up on it for the rest of the year. The other thing I find weird about this is that the current lineup, the modern lineup of Lumia phones, is the three of them essentially. There's a 950, which is a smartphone. There's a 950 XL, which is a phablet. They're high-end phones. They come in dual and single SIM variants, whatever, basically the same devices. And then there's a 550, which is kind of an entry-level device. And all of them share a certain look and feel. They look the same. They have plastic backs. You can pop the back off, access the internals of battery, replace the back with a new one if you want to buy a nicer-looking design. What's missing from this picture, I guess, if you need a full product line for some reason, would be kind of a mid-level phone, something between the 550 and the 950. So the 650 sounds like that's what it is, except it's not. It's just a low-end phone. It's another low-end phone, but it has a metal body.
Yeah.
So the 650 is going to have a nicer body than the 950 and the 950 XL. And I don't understand what, you know, what problem that solves. Like, I don't get that.
Yeah. The three groups they said they were trying to address with Windows phones were entry level, flagship,
people,
and business.
Yeah.
Business was the third group.
So I
don't know. Would
metal,
this be a business?
Business needs metal.
I don't get it.
Yeah. I do not get it. So we'll see what happens with that.
Farshad, that's all we know.
That's all we know, and there ain't no more.
Yeah.
Somebody in the chat room suggested that Continuum might make sense in a developing market as opposed to enterprise market.
Yep, I think so too.
Right, where that's literally the only computer. Yeah. Yep.
Hey, good news. Oil just closed at the lowest price it's been at since December 2001. So go out and take a drive today.
My son, who, as you pointed out, spent some time in the hospital, is a font of useless trivia. And he pointed out that the barrel that oil would come in is more expensive than the oil it would contain.
that's a really good observation. It would be.
If oil came in barrels, Leo. I said, you know, they haven't shipped oil in barrels since, I don't know, the 1800s. What are you talking about?
I'll take two barrels of oil and a, I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, like a barrel of rum.
yeah, give me a flag and a rum.
This is not how things are.
Two barrels of oil.
You don't transport anything by barrel anymore. I mean, unless it's like wine or something. I don't know.
Bourbon barrels, my friend.
Even wine, really. I mean, you kind of age wine in barrels or something just to get the... I don't know. Anyway,
barrels. There are things still in barrels.
What you're saying, Paul, is it's now a unit of measurement, not an actual barrel.
Yes.
There's no actual barrel. We're going to talk about Force HDR in just a second. More Windows Phone camera information this time around, and I'll tell you the story of my Tesla. But first, an ongoing saga of pain and frustration. And now that I'm seeing oil at $26 a barrel, I'm thinking, what the hell am I doing? I should just get a gas guzzler. I maybe go get a Hummer 2 instead.
Oh, Leo.
I'm looking to the future, Paul.
It doesn't sound like you are.
Electricity is expensive.
What you're talking about is petroleum innovation.
Actually, somebody told me it is. I guess it was Ben Thompson said it's all because of fracking. That's, you know.
The success of fracking.
The success of fracking, ladies and gentlemen. The earth may collapse, but oil's cheap.
Yeah.
Our show today is brought to you by Harry's. Time to talk about why. You may have noticed, I think you probably did when I came in, how clean shaven I am. You know what? My chin is soft as a baby's butt. I can thank Harry's for that. Harry's is a better way to shave at a much more reasonable price. Now that oil's $26 a barrel, why are you still paying $8 for a razor blade? The other day, I was stunned. I went to CVS and they've locked them up like solid gold, of course, the razor blades. And the price is like, I was going to buy a package of razor blades. It was like, it was $48. And I thought, I don't need these. Thank you. Goodbye. Harry's is great. A great shave at a great price, as low as $2 a blade. And they come delivered direct to your door. The reason is because Harry's bought the razor factory in Germany that's been crafting some of the world's highest quality blades for almost a century, and they sell them at factory direct prices. You're buying from the factory, so as a result, you're getting an amazing deal. Harry's has been adding some great new gift items, including their travel kit, the Harry's razor holder, and of course, this beautiful Winston set, the Winter Winston. I just love it. Go to HARRYS.com. It's time for a fresh start for 2016. Enjoy shaving for a change. You got to do it every day. So why not go to Harry's? The $15 Truman set, the $25 Winston set, the $30 Winter Winston set with a beautiful metal copper handle. It's beautiful. And every set includes that, not only the handle, but three blades, the travel cover, and your choice of foaming shave gel or the Harry's shave cream. And these are not sample sizes. These are full-size bottles. So it's a really great deal. And we'll do you a deal. We'll take $5 off your first order when you enter the offer code Windows. And right now, Harry's is offering a trial offer for a limited time. You get their trial box and just pay $3 for shipping. What? I got to find out more about this. Harry's.com and start the free trial. Oh, look at that. You get the handle, the blade. What? How do they do that? That's a great deal. For just $3 for shipping. This is even better than ever before. This is kind of an experiment. They're trying this right now. You can get their trial box, pay $3 for shipping, and if you miss that offer, use the code Windows and get $5 off your first order. HARRYS. Forget everything I've just said. This is such a good deal. Harry's.com/Windows. Try it for free. You just pay $3 shipping, and then you get the shave plan so that they automatically refill your blades and your shave gel and everything. Okay, if you've been waiting, if you were smart enough to wait, this is the deal of the century. Harry's.com. Here's the deal. Use the offer code Windows at checkout. Okay? Use the offer code Windows at checkout. I might try, I like the orange handle. I'm going to go with the white handle. And I'm going to do that 2 to 4 days a week. And I'm going to, look at that. And I'm going to get my box. And then you proceed to checkout. $3! And make sure, once you do all that, that you use the offer code Windows. Harry's. Wow. The reason you want to use the offer code is to let them know that you heard it on Windows Weekly. Paul and Mary Jo will thank you for that. All right, moving right along. What is this Force HDR feature? And whose idea was this?
Well, iPhone and Android have HDR or HDR Plus, whatever. It's a toggle. You turn it on, you turn it off, you put it on auto. Those are the choices. And so with Windows Phone 8.1 and high-end Lumias, Microsoft introduced a feature that was sort of HDR plus some other stuff. And it's a cool feature, but it's because it allows you to go back into the photo and edit it after the fact, and you can remove the HDR effects, you can remove the The flash effect, if that came on, you can remove some other stuff. But it's really strange. In Windows 10 Mobile with the new 950, 950 XL, you actually get rich capture. You can turn it on auto or you can turn it off, but you can't force it to be on. And if you have a lower end phone where you don't get rich capture, you just have HDR, it's the same thing. HDR can be on auto or it can be off. And a lot of people are like, well, I just want it to be on. Could I just leave? I want always on HDR, force HDR, like every other smartphone on earth. And so someone from Microsoft said that, Microsoft's imaging chief, formerly of Nokia, said a lot of people have told us that they want this and it is coming soon. And so they're going to add it to the official camera app in Windows 10. And so I assume that also means force rich capture, you know, for higher end phones because it's more than just HDR. But he did say that this would be coming. So just it's a big deal because obviously the cameras are a big selling point on Lumia in particular. And it was such a weird thing. The way they did it was very, it was one of those things you notice right away where you're like, wait, what? How come I can't just turn this on? Because I would just turn it on, personally. Yeah. But it wasn't a choice.
No, yeah. Does it slow it down? Because that's one of the reasons you don't turn on some other phones.
Yep. And that's actually one of the kind of bummers about the 950, 950 XL. When you take a photo with rich capture on in particular, if you go right to the camera roll to look at that photo, you can see it. But there's some message that says like, please wait while we're processing. It takes a while. Like you sit there and watch it and you're like, seriously, I want to zoom in on this and edit it maybe. You really have to wait because it's still processing the image and then writing it to the disk and so forth. Yeah, it is slow.
You guys using 950s now as your daily drivers?
No.
You got to give up that Verizon thing, Mary Jo. That's just not good for you.
Right. I go back and forth on phones. I mean, I have one of those Nexus 6Ps, which I really like a lot on the Google Fi service, an iPhone, obviously, and the 950. And I prefer the interface on Windows. I really do. I really love it. But it really, when it comes to apps, it's getting harder and harder as time goes on to justify denying yourself access to the best apps. Yeah. And that's the hard, I think that's the hard part.
I know. It's okay. No judging. No judgment.
It's okay.
Okay. Did you get your build tickets?
We don't.
I literally blinked and missed it.
So you don't need them, though. That's okay.
That's true.
Build is coming to San Francisco, I'm happy to say, March 30th. Through April 1st, but it's sold out.
Is that 2 days or 3 days? Is that the last day of the month or the second last day?
It's, 30 days. March. It's 3 days.
3 days.
Yeah, it's Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. Yeah. Right. So registration opened for it yesterday at noon Eastern, and people immediately noted it was sold out, like even before they could try to get a ticket for it. So Microsoft says it sold out, depending on who you listen to, either in 1 minute or less than 5 minutes. But I am hearing nothing but complaints from the people who got closed out that they never even had a chance. Yeah. And there are people who said, people at my company who got like a waitlist notification after me, then got a subsequent email from Microsoft an hour or two later that said, you're in.
Wow.
Yep.
So it was, I used the word fiasco, and I don't use that word a lot in blog posts, but I called
this fiasco. You're not a fan of hyperbole, is that what you're saying?
Yeah, they've got to fix the registration process for Build. It's really broken, and, you know, it doesn't make sense to turn away all these people who are willing to pay you $2,000, and by the way, for no hardware giveaway this year.
Yeah.
They put that on the site.
By the way, do you think that's a big deal?
Oh, based on my Twitter stream, yes.
So
a lot of people go because they justify it like this. Oh, I'm going to get a free laptop and it costs $2,000 to go to the show. So it doesn't really cost me anything, right?
Watch. Yeah, but I mean, are most of the people going to Build paying for it out of pocket or are they, you know, is it something where you convince your boss to let you go?
Yeah, good question. I think it's a mix.
I mean, I would say for the people whose businesses are paying for it, if companies are paying for it, you know, it's almost like this little secret thing. It's like, not only are they paying me for me to go to San Francisco, but I'm going to get a free laptop.
Get a laptop. Yeah.
I can tell you, I can share a little bit about Google's experience with this, because, of course, I think Google I.O. got very quickly oversubscribed because they gave away so much stuff.
People and just going just for the stuff.
They just go for the stuff. And, right. Of course, you have to pay $2,000 and you get $1,000 worth of free stuff. That's not such a good deal, but... I think
you get it first, you know, maybe
giving away free stuff, it probably encourages the wrong sort.
Yeah. So all Microsoft said on their site is there won't be free hardware. And I think they did that to dampen some people's expectations they were going to get the HoloLens there. Ooh, the people really did think that.
Oh, no.
Maybe they're going to get existing hardware, like a Surface Book.
You might get a fleece pullover.
You know what? No, you know what? I bet they give them. They're going to give them cloud stuff like Azure credits, right? Which would be pretty awesome to get. That's my guess. They're going to give them software and services.
And then they need to do what Google does, which is do a lottery. I understand there's a limit to how many people can come in with a popular game like this.
That's interesting.
But that's what Google does. They have a sign-up period, and then they have a drawing.
Yeah, they really screwed this one up.
It was bad. Yeah, Paul, you were at lunch. So, like, I
went to lunch and came back, and this whole thing happened. And I'm like, what the heck? I was gone for, 23 minutes.
I tweeted, build registration is open. And then suddenly I was on Twitter. Every single person who was being refused was like, Mary Jo, help me, help me. I couldn't get in. Help me.
Did they not say ahead of time when it was going to open?
Yeah, they did. But the server was broken, I believe, because it immediately was kicking people out and saying you're on the wait list. Even like if you got in the first 30 seconds, you were getting the wait list message.
Not a good message to send for a company that wants to be known for its cloud solution.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. Yep. One guy tweeted, maybe they should use AWS for their...
Hey.
I didn't say that.
I'm sorry. Is Amazon still in business? I thought they lost money every quarter.
Not this quarter.
Actually, their AWS business does not lose money.
No, it does not.
Anyway,
but it's going to be big.
Even Miguel de Xcasa today said he was appealing to Microsoft and saying, you guys should move this and maybe take it out of San Francisco because you need a bigger venue for this.
I've been begging them to do that.
Moscone
is whatever size it is, but they're not in Moscone. They're across the street in mini Moscone, right? They're in like the small part of Moscone.
Oh, yeah, because Moscone West is pretty big.
No,
you
is
can
it?
Get a okay. lot of people. Is there, it Moscone it's not the whole West?
Yeah, so, but why not spread out to the whole thing?
I don't know how many people they let in. I forget. Was last year 5,000 or was it 2,000?
Where were they? I mean, do they need to go to Vegas? I mean, put this thing in the convention center? Or?
No.
I'm just thinking about getting the maximum number of people
I don't, you know, there's a point.
Go back to LA. I mean, what's wrong with the LVC or the Los Angeles Convention Center? Yeah.
I don't know. No. I think something has to change, though, because this year it was really, it really put a lot of people off.
Yeah. That's too bad.
Yeah, I agree. I was really disappointed when they said earlier it was going to be in San Francisco again. I really wish they'd figure something else out. Not that I don't love San Francisco. It's just that it's a tough trip, and this is what happens. They're just disappointing people.
I think that doesn't. There's a limit to how big you can make a developer conference before it's just too big to be managed. Are they going to have satellite? They'll have streams,
probably.
Right?
They'll probably have satellite conferences. They said they're going to stream the keynotes like they did last year.
Stuff.
Yeah.
Stream all the sessions. That's what Google's doing now. And I think
but I guess when you're selling it in 5 minutes,
1 minute,
or 1 minute, whatever it is, you know, you gotta think you could have a bigger crowd there.
Yeah.
They're not in it for the money.
I know, but this is, you know, are we not seriously wondering every year why everyone's so interested in these Microsoft developer platforms? I don't see anyone making major new Microsoft platform-based applications or services or whatever. I mean, at some point, don't you sort of, it's amazing that they are able to get this level of interest in this thing. I really wish they would reward these people and let more of them in.
Right.
You know? It's too bad.
Certainly. Yeah.
They'll probably do like a build road show. I think they do one of those every year where they, you know, bring part of the show to different cities around the country and probably Europe and elsewhere. And there are other shows and many things. And, you know, like you said, they'll do the remote streaming and all that stuff. But It's tough when something awesome like this happens, and it's kind of disappointing. You know,
it's okay. I was going there for the Android bridge anyway, so.
Well, then you won't be disappointed.
You can swim, right, Leo?
Yeah. No, the iOS bridge is alive, but didn't they kill the Android bridge, really?
Yes, they did.
We think.
Yeah.
We think they did.
Yeah.
They still haven't said that.
Yeah. But the iOS bridge is alive and kicking.
Yeah. Yep. Yeah. Our friend Kasim Ketfi at frauwin.com found this. This was pretty good. He found a note that Microsoft had appended to its website that said, hey, we're going to have this new analyzer tool ready in a few weeks that's going to analyze your iOS apps for compatibility with our bridge. So now it's moving forward. And some people think because they're putting so much attention right now on the iOS bridge that they've decided, you know what, if we can get iOS apps on Windows 10, maybe that's enough and we don't have to care about the Android apps. I don't know. I think that's probably true.
I mean, pick one. You don't want two Instagrams, yeah. You know. I mean, it makes sense. Sure. Pick the one that's going to be the most popular and go all out.
And the iOS bridge doesn't include an emulator like the Android one did. So the developer has to actually basically port the app, right? It's not like you can just take the app as it exists and run it in emulation on Windows Phone. It doesn't work like that.
Right.
Right.
Yep.
What else? The Microsoft Edge Web Summit.
This is the second one they've done. Is that right?
Mm-hmm. It is
A one-day conference. It's basically a web dev show. It's you might think of it as maybe the new Mix, I guess.
Kind of, right? It's
but for Edge. Called Edge?
No, it is for Edge. It's specifically for Edge.
Okay.
Yeah, it's the Monday after build ends. So, you know, if you're a developer and you can hang around San Francisco for the weekend and then go to this, you can make a long weekend.
I don't think this one's going to sell it in 5 minutes. Let's put it that way. No problem getting into this.
Just stroll right in. We were talking last week about
walk-ins,
messaging and who uses Skype for messaging. I'm sure you got a few tweets. I did. I use it. Actually, I got one.
Yep.
I use it. But now that Skype and Slack are integrated, that's interesting.
It is.
I don't know what that means funny. Exactly. But
right after the show, the next day, I think this came out. There's a preview out now of Skype Consumer integrated with Slack. And for Paul, because he says he doesn't know what Slack is.
What?
Slack it's does. A team what? Collaboration platform that's like an instant messaging type collaboration.
It's really awesome messaging.
Words.
But so is the Skype integration about messaging? No, it's about phone video calls.
Right. Yeah. So when you're in Slack, if you want to stay in Slack and immediately call and contact someone that way, you can do it from inside Slack.
And there's more coming for other third-party services too. But you actually trigger a Skype call with a command line.
How Slack is.
That's crazy.
Yeah.
It's so weird.
But that's what you're going to see, Paul, with messaging. Messaging is the return of the command line, which is very strange.
I should embrace that. It's interesting.
You should embrace it. You're an old-school kind of guy.
So we asked if they also will do this for Slack for Business, because a lot of people would be very interested in that. And they said, we're going to wait and see what people want.
Yeah. I thought they said it was coming later.
Nope.
No? No. No. You must have covered this somewhere.
Make sense to do it, I think. But
I thought they said Skype for Business was coming later. No?
Maybe they added that, because when I asked them, they said, we have nothing to say.
We have nothing to say.
I mean, it took me like 37 hours to figure out what Slack even was.
What? And then that time, really, Paul? You're not in touch with this.
Listen, you're talking to the guy who thought Pinterest was pronounced P-interest. What do you think? How would I know what Slack is?
That's true.
At least there's no trouble pronouncing it.
True.
It says, okay, let me see.
Slack is awesome. Everybody uses Slack.
Oh, it's not even in my post. I don't know. Skype. Yeah.
Slack is the coolest. It's kind of an interesting. It's just messaging.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's
but
just
people
messaging.
People use it for Teams. You know, some people consider it a head-to-head competitor with Yammer.
Yeah, it beat Yammer is what happened. Right. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, Yammer's kind of
It kind of dominated. It ended up just kind of... It's Stuart Butterfield did it, the guy who started Flickr.
Yeah.
And it's just taken the developer world by storm. But it's spreading. It's interesting because it is so aesthetically pleasing. A lot of people use it for personal messaging. And now there's actually a fight to keep open source projects from using it for the, instead of IRC for their
really?
Chats. Wow. Yeah, because people like it so much, but it's a closed source product. And people are saying, you can't use that for an open source forum. I'm excited about my... I'm sorry. Before we do this, something I'm less excited about. WordFlow keyboard coming to iOS. This is...
So Brad wrote this, not me, but let me tell you something. And I mean this really honestly.
You really like it.
I really like the Windows Phone keyboard, the WordFlow keyboard. Hmm. I have huge problems with the keyboard on the iPhone.
It's terrible. It's horrible.
It's comical.
Yeah.
The text that it takes and then what it generates is like a Doonesbury cartoon from 30 years ago or whatever that was. I guess 20 years ago. It is unbelievably bad. And so I don't remember what version of iOS. I'm not the big Apple guy, but let's say iOS 8 or something. I think they started, maybe it was 9. They started opening up. Third party keyboards. So that's a cool idea. I assume they're going to bring it to Android as well. And I also assume that somewhere out there, there are Windows phone fans committing Harry Carey.
Now tell me, because I haven't really used it. But so the WordFlow stuff is very commonplace on almost all Android keyboards. It's not on the Mac side. But is that the big feature, or is you saying predictions better? Or, I mean, what do you like about WordFlow?
Well, I'm talking about phones specifically. So it versus iPhone. Yeah, it's just more accurate. It's one of the big problems I have
swiping.
With the iPhone. Yeah.
Yeah. And Swipe is available for the iPhone. It has been for some time.
Yep. Yep.
And on Android, almost all the first-party and third-party keyboards have swiping capability.
All right. So it's not worth bringing up on the phone, but the default iOS keyboard I hate. It doesn't have punctuation for some reason. It's stupid.
Yeah.
The accuracy, whether you're typing or swiping, is much worse than on Windows anyway. I'm not sure about Android. The fact that you can replace this with a third-party keyboard, to me, I think is a great idea.
Yeah.
If I could get the one that I love from Windows Phone on this platform, that would make it easier to use. And I know that freaks people out, but I think that's a good thing overall. So
I'll give you some bad news, which is I've been trying to use third-party keyboards on iOS for some time.
Yeah.
And I always go back to the original because Apple has real mixed mixed opinions of this. So, for instance, anytime you need to enter something securely, it reverts to the Apple keyboard, which is exactly when you want a better keyboard because you can't type passwords very well. Yeah. And it's things like that that just finally you just go, okay, I give up. You don't want third-party keyboards. I got it.
Yeah. But so I could see that.
I'll try it. I mean,
I'm very interested in this. It's one of the big problems I have with iOS.
I agree. It chased me away from iOS for a long time.
Yeah.
The Apple problem is not
going. That's the whole Apple thing. That's the
bastards. It ain't going away. This was, the one I was going to say I was excited about is Minecraft.edu. Kids love Minecraft. You talk to any 10, 11, 12-year-old, Minecraft.
50-year-old, whatever, sure.
Even Paul's starting to get into it.
Yeah.
Yeah. So it makes sense to use it for education, and Microsoft apparently is going full bore. Yep. What are they doing?
Yeah, they bought this product that's called Minecraft.edu from Teacher Gaming, which is a company with offices in Finland and New York. And what this is a classroom adaptation of Minecraft. So it's made into more of a learning tool. And Microsoft's going to invest in that and create a more expanded version of the product and make it available to people who already are subscribers to Minecraft EDU as well as a new customer base. So we don't know yet. Really, I don't believe we know how much they're going to charge for the new version, but the preview that will be out this summer will be free. What else? We don't know how much they paid for this acquisition. And they did not buy all of Teacher Gaming. I saw a few people saying that. But no, they just bought this one product from them. And Teacher Gaming is a company that seems to do a lot of this, turning gaming products into more something you can use in the classroom as a teacher or a student. So, yeah, pretty interesting.
Great news.
So
finding something to do with Minecraft.
There is a fee for Minecraft EDU today. It's like there a is, server okay. fee or something. But I guess the New York Times says that the cost for this new game, which will be called Minecraft Education Edition, is $5 per student per school year.
Okay.
And that probably does just pay for server space.
Yeah, I would think so.
Or not, maybe not server space, but server use.
Just the cost of that.
You need
that
a centralized server to do this. Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah.
Although that is enough to keep some.
It sounds like they're kind of turning it into an online service almost. I wonder if that's not part of the deal.
Well, it kind of is. So the way, you know this, Paul, the way you use Minecraft, you could use it standalone. But mostly what people want to do is play with other people.
And I wish, you know, I really don't quite understand what Microsoft gets out of Minecraft. But I have to say, now that they have it, the one thing they could do to make Minecraft awesome would be to really get all of the versions working together and allow you to work on a world on the PC and then go onto your phone and continue with that same world. Yeah. It would be amazing if you could go from device to device.
I think that is the same server. Oh, I know why you can't, because they don't have a personal edition.
The pocket edition doesn't have all everything. Of the features. Right.
Yeah.
They need the same features across the board. That's a universal app. would be such a huge thing.
You want to sell some Windows phones?
Yeah. Yep.
Put a full Minecraft on her.
Yeah. Right.
Wouldn't that be interesting?
If you want to know what Microsoft gets out of Minecraft, isn't it still the highest paid app in the iOS and Android stores?
Yeah, it is. But most of those sales came from before Microsoft bought them. It's not like it's going to,
They pay $3 billion.
Never add up to $2.5
billion. $2.5
billion,
right. Yeah.
No, it's goodwill. It's reputation. It's
getting in with the younger audience.
With the kids today, you know. How
so
they
it's
are.
Like the change bank strategy. We're just going to go for volume. Is it?
No, it's smart. I think it's $2.5 billion. That's nothing to Microsoft. And it's how much have they lost on Xbox?
No, Leo, we can't add that. We have one of the original Pentiums, and it doesn't do floating point. I don't know. Yeah, right. Several billion on each version, I think, is how it works out. Mm-hmm.
Speaking of which, you got some news for Xbox lovers, a new set of features.
Which, as noted, Mary Jo actually added to the notes for some reason. I don't.
She put that in?
Can't believe
she put the exclamation point in.
Oh, okay.
Yeah,
she's got very so excited. I think that's an ironic exclamation point. So if there is such a thing, such a thing.
I'm going to take the enthusiasm, whether it's forced or not.
Take it.
Most months, Microsoft releases a system update for Xbox One, and they didn't actually release one in December of last year, and they're not going to release one this month, but they are going to release one next month. And if you're on the preview program, of course, you get it this month. In fact, I got it. I think I just got it last night or this morning or whatever. And they took a month off or two. I guess it works as 2 months, really. But they're really adding a lot of features into this update, so it's really cool. And none of this applies to me in the slightest. But some of these features also apply to the Xbox app on Windows 10, the Xbox beta app. And so starting next week on Windows 10, you'll be able to get some of these features as well. And just kind of going through it, I mean, for me personally, actually, none of this is particularly... It's all that exciting, like an avatar store.
I like your name for Party Peak, though. That's good.
Party Peak. I know. I can't believe they didn't use that name.
Party Peak.
And the new Xbox Guide, you know, the ability to see who's in a party before you join it. In other words, one of your friends says, hey, join my party. And, you know, you're going to get into some game. And you're like, okay. And then you get in there and you realize a bunch of people.
Losers.
So now you kind of peek into the party first and then decide whether to join it. Really, really smart.
I wish we had that for real life.
I do too. I know exactly. What are you doing tonight? Why?
Tell me about it. Just give me some information before
someone invites you over to dinner and you arrive and there's another couple there too. And it's like, thanks.
I know. I've had that happen. I don't like that.
Yeah.
No.
You could have told me.
I don't either. Especially when they ask you to bring the wine.
Yeah. Oh, there's another couple.
Really? Oh. Nice. I've brought enough for me and you. I don't know who these are.
I don't like them. All right, yeah. Party Peak, Gamerscore leaderboard.
That is the one I might be interested in, yeah. So Gamerscore leaderboard is where you can look at Gamerscore between you and your friends and see where you rank according to them
Again,
and compare achievements.
Again, great real-life feature.
That was part of 360, yeah. Because really it's about the competition.
Yeah, life is.
Speaking of which, an important Xbox news, I did get the Diamond Rocket Launcher, or I guess it's not really an achievement, but a... challenge, I guess, on Xbox or on Black Ops 3. So my son has lost all respect for me because of that.
What?
Because it's a noob tube thing. And he's like, you know, he's like, so you spent time
trying to get,
you got gold on all of the rockets and then thus achieved the diamond. You know, like you are.
He's just jealous.
No, he's not.
Apparently, Jason Kleanthis knows that too, because he just called you a noob tuber too. Noob tuber.
You've called me names today. Let me tell you one more story. This involves my son. So I got that Xbox controller, that awesome controller. He comes home from school one day, and I said, "Listen to me. You gotta check this out." And I handed it to him. And I walked into the other room. I made some tea or whatever. Blah blah blah. And so he played the game that I had just started online, like a multiplayer game. And so because he was in the middle of the game, I let him finish the game. He's like, "Yeah, this is really nice." And then he walked out of the room, and I sat down. And then you get the little, it says the little things that you did in that game. And one of the things I did in that game that I didn't play, my son played, it said, "You just achieved the highest ever kill rate you've ever had." And so he just stood there with the controller, played one game, and wiped out 4 months of experience in one game. That's what he did to me.
And here he comes.
Yeah, that's a previous Black Ops. Yeah.
Yeah, 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 yeah. Watch this. He's about to noob tube.
Yeah, you do it from across the map.
Yeah.
Oh, and it bounced. Yeah.
Oh,
so he's going to ricochet.
Oh, no, yep. No, don't do that. Oh, you knew. Oh, my God. Through a skate park, bounced off the ramp, up through the hole, through a window, off a bathroom door, up through the skylight. Nothing.
It's like the Larry Bird McDonald's commercial.
Nothing but net.
It's the cross map noob tubing is the best. Yeah, they have the best game. Yeah. That's nice. We're actually moving across maps now.
This is in a different world. Boing. Through a pool. Yep. And finally, I presume at some point it's going to hit somebody.
I don't know what's going on there.
It's still going. Mary Jo's going, "Really, guys? Really? Really?" I think it might be fake.
Oh no, it's not. Yeah,
no, I'm kidding. I know, of course. Of course. I can't take this away from you though. We gotta keep watching until he actually blows somebody
out.
I know,
I want to see what happens. At the end he's gonna be like, "Dude, I totally no scoped you." Yep. Yuketown.
Downstairs. Off the oven door. Somebody's watching TV. Into a backyard. Nuketown. Oh, he blew it up. Oh, nope. Still going. Still going. Mary Jo's really wondering now. What is
this? Like, at the end, does it like say Hadoop or something?
Yeah, that would be funny.
Great.
That should do that.
Powered by Azure.
Tell you what, let's take a break, and I'm going to do an ad. Yeah. We've got another 2 minutes to go, but we'll get to the end of this noob tube. But first, a word from Wealthfront. Oh, man. Oh, man. As the stock market tanks today, there are people who are happy and there are people who are sad. If you are in the stock market for the long term, you know that these things happen. But really, are you monitoring your investments carefully? Did you get out of the market? Did you figure out what was going to happen? See, if you had Wealthfront, you wouldn't have to worry about it. It's the most tax-efficient, low-cost, hassle-free way to invest. It's automated investment, so you don't have to pay those 1%, 2%, and 3% advisor fees, nor do you have to constantly monitor your investment, because no one's going to do that. With Wealthfront, your money grows, your tax rate goes, and you can find out what's going on at any minute of the day with the Wealthfront dashboard. We've heard from so many Twit fans who are now Wealthfront customers who love how they can diversify their portfolio, buy stocks from in-demand companies like Apple and Amazon and Facebook, all without commission, all at the lowest cost ever, 0.25% per year with Wealthfront. This is software. It's software, of course. You don't have to pay software as much. But it's software with the brains of some of the best investors in the world, people like Burton Malkiel and Charles D. Ellis. If you've got a long-term investment, whether it's for retirement, your kids' college education, personal or joint, you will love Wealthfront. And the sophisticated stuff they do, like tax loss harvesting, and direct indexing, optimized after-tax returns. And by the way, this is fun. They have now a timeline of the history. Started in December 2011. There they are ringing the opening bell at NASDAQ. Commissions eliminated. Tax loss harvesting. There's Dr. Malkiel, brilliant guy. Differentiation. Read the website. Go to the website. Check it out. And by the way, minimum investment now down to $500. So it's very easy to get started. They are now up to, what is it, $2.6 billion in client assets. That's 20 times growth in 2 years. Brilliant stuff. Wealthfront.com/windows. You get an extra special deal. Your first $15,000. Not 1-3% a year, not 0.25% a year, but nothing. Free forever. Wealthfront.com/windows. It is the way to invest in these uncertain times. Wealthfront.com/windows. Paul Thurrott, Mary Jo Foley. We're talking Windows, Windows Weekly. Let's kick things off in the back of the book here with Paul's tip of the week.
I have two tips this week, although I guess the first one is technically also a software pick. If you're running Windows 7 or Windows 8.1, you know that Microsoft has a pretty aggressive advertising campaign with that Get Windows 10 flag logo down there in the tray. There's no way to actually get rid of it. You pretty much just have to say yes or yes, I'll do it in a little while. And I wish it wasn't that aggressive. There have been a lot of attempts to get fixes for this, you know, registry hacks and removing certain updates and everything. And Microsoft has just kind of worked around all of these things over time. But dating back to last August, it's an individual makes an application called the GWX Control Panel. And he's updated it as Microsoft has updated their methods for, you know, spamming people with Windows 10 advertisements. And, you know, in the interest of just giving people what they want, I think if you do not want to get Windows 10 or you want to wait on Windows 10 for some amount of time or whatever, get this, because this will remove the advertisement from your computer, and it seems to work. So it's called GWX Control Panel. It looks like the solution until Microsoft blows them out of the water at some future date.
Well, they did. So, you know, Microsoft has a whole page devoted to how to get rid of it. Mm. You didn't see that?
No, of course I do. Yeah. Insidious.
It's and by the way, it involves registry editing.
Sure. Of course it does. That's the way we do everything.
It's crazy.
It is
so
crazy.
You're right. Does the control panel still work? Use it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yes, yeah. That's absolutely the best. Yeah.
And if you're in the market, so the other tip, I guess, is that if you're in the market for Microsoft Band, you may recall back in December, they had a great $50 off deal for Band 2. I actually used it to bought one for my wife for Christmas. I try to stay away from technology gifts for her, but I thought she would enjoy this thing, and she does. So we don't have that anymore. But what Microsoft does have, if you buy a Band 2 at a Microsoft store online only, you have to do it online, U.S., Puerto Rico, and Canada, you can trade in an existing smartwatch or fitness device and get up to $250 off. Although, ooh, to be fair, most of them are nowhere even close to that. So to qualify for $200 or $250, what you have to be trading in is a certain kind of Apple Watch. $150 for the sport model. But if you have, like a Fit Charge HR, for example, is worth $75 on trade-in. Oh. And the way it works is you basically go through the process of, and you have, this is the part you have to do by the end of the month. So it's just for January only. Go through the process of saying, you'd like to buy a band, but I'm going to send in a device. Microsoft or a company working with Microsoft will send you the information you need to make that happen. They'll evaluate it. You can accept it. And when you do accept it, you'll get that amount of money off of your band 2 purchase, which you can then make. So it's not an instant gratification thing. But if you want to move to band 2 from another device, you have a device you tested and stop using or whatever, it's definitely worth checking out. And you can just find this information at the Microsoft store online. So microsoftstore.com.
Yeah, you have to go through the process of buying it before, but it does say trade-in offer available.
Yeah.
And then I wonder, because I have a Moto 360 I'm not using. It's probably worth a couple of bucks.
I don't think that one's on the list.
No,
yeah,
it's not worth anything. Okay, thank you. That's good.
No, well, no, actually, the Moto 360 is a nice
I like it, yeah.
It's a nice watch. Yeah.
I'm not giving them my Apple Watch, though. I paid a lot of money for it.
I know. It's like, a $400 watch, and you can get $150 bucks for it. It's no. Like, you could get more for that selling it, obviously.
Yeah. All right, it's time for Hadoop, or at least
the Enterprise pick of the week.
Yes, the Enterprise pick of the week this week is kind of a non-pick. Back at Ignite last year, Microsoft was talking about coming out with a convenience roll-up for Windows 7. So this was going to be a roll-up of all the important fixes. It wasn't exactly Windows 7 Service Pack 2, but it was kind of the next best thing. And they said they were planning to have it out probably before the end of 2015. So 2015 came and went, so I decided to ask, where is it, Microsoft? And the answer made it sound like you're probably not going to see it ever. Because the priority now is Windows 10, and, you know, that's that. So yep. If you were one of the people who was waiting for the convenience roll-up, I would say probably don't hold your breath on that one. But I do have a bonus pick, a pick that is actually more of a true pick. Just came out today. SharePoint Server 2016 release candidate. It's out. It's available to testers. Woo! And Project Server 2016 release candidate.
Even better.
Even better.
Even better.
Yep, so you can go test those now, download them from the Microsoft Download Center, and they are saying they're still on track to have the next version of SharePoint Server out, which is 2016, in the spring of this year. This post I wrote about this is also worth looking at if you're one of those people who are wondering what's going on with InfoPath. Remember InfoPath?
Mm.
Microsoft Electronics Forum product. They said they were going to drop
yeah.
a long time ago. But now they've got a whole, I guess because a lot of people still did need it and they didn't really have a good resolution for what you should do if you did need it. They've got some guidance in their blog post today about how long they're going to support InfoPath and what the various support paths for it are. So it's worth going into the FAQ and reading the fine print for that one.
Now, we don't have a code name exactly. We have a product name.
Yeah.
What is that?
So this week I did a product name pick of the week because this is going to be very important around build, I believe. The product we've been calling ASP.NET 5, which is the new version of ASP.NET that Microsoft's building, is no longer called that. It is now called ASP.NET Core 1.0.
Oh, I can't wait to hear you explain this one.
I was hoping something more jazzy, but
this
okay.
This is insanity.
Okay, here's why. Back in December of 2014, Microsoft actually forked .NET, and they created this thing called .NET Core, which is a fork of the .NET framework. And so .NET kind of veered off into two different paths. ASP.NET 5 was based on the .NET Core. So they decided instead of making it look like it was the next version to succeed 4.6, that they indicate in the name of the product that it actually was a brand new path. And so that's why they're calling it ASP.NET Core. The core is the key word there, 1.0. And if you've heard Microsoft talk about .NET 5 before, that now is going to be called .NET Core 1.0, just to keep things really confusing. If you want to read more on why they did this, go to Scott Hanselman's blog, Hanselman.com, because he's the one who came out publicly and said this is the new way it's going to be. So you can read all the gory details and background and a nice little architectural diagram from him, too, about the future of the naming of these things.
I kind of like Scott because he's got a sense of humor.
He does.
I really Scott.
He's awesome.
Yeah.
He's an insane person. Yeah. It's hard not to love him. Yeah. He's just crazy.
He's a guy.
Yeah, look, if you look at that diagram on his site, he talks about how some of these things are open source and some are not.
Yeah.
How you've got the .NET framework libraries and then the .NET core library. So right. it's a really good diagram if you're a little confused about the differences between what's in the .NET framework and what's in .NET core.
Clear as mud.
No, it's actually a good diagram.
For those who understand it, it all makes perfect sense. For the rest, there's beer.
There it is.
Yep.
Yep.
So this was a great suggestion by one of our listeners, Kurt S. He said, you know, you make all these great beer picks, but a lot of them are hard to get. And I think you should do a beer pick that's much more accessible, but still really an amazing beer. So he suggested, and I agreed, on Left Hand Milk Stout from Left Hand Brewing in Colorado.
I feel like I've had this.
Yeah, I bet you have. It's fairly easy to find, and it's really a good stout. It's almost like a beginner stout. If you're somebody who's not really all that sure about this craft beer thing, check out Left Hand Milk Stout. Smooth, chocolatey, easy to drink, not too high alcohol, like a very nice introduction to a stout from a craft beer brewer.
It's milk stout for the for the babies.
You put it in a bottle and they go right to it.
Right to it. Yep.
And you could drink a lot of those and be lulled to sleep.
Love it. Love it. Love it. Looks good. I need a beginner stout. So
I think you would like that one.
Yeah.
Nice and smooth. Easy to drink.
Creamy smooth. Ladies and gentlemen, there is no one smoother than Mary Jo Foley. She's at allaboutmicrosoft.com. And that is the place to go to keep up on everything going on. And she breaks a lot of stories there. Paul Thurrott is also the king of things like Windows and Windows Phone. And the
king of things.
The king of things.
Not as good as the king of kings, but it's not terrible.
Better than the king of queens.
Yep.
You'll find him at Thurrott.com. Thurrott.com. He's also... like Mary Jo on the Twitter. He's at Thurrott. She's at Mary Jo Foley. And you are at Windows Weekly. And we are at the end. You can watch the show eventually. Close. Not of the whole show. What are you saying? Something they should know about? You want it to be over?
Like no, he wants you to show that video again of that bullet.
Oh, we haven't finished.
I mean, it would be more impressive if it were real.
I have real new tubing if you want. You want real new tubing? Noob tubing?
Oh, sure.
All right, let's check here.
I see what I did.
What is noob tubing?
It's using a rocket, which is a secondary weapon, to attack people instead of using the gun. Some versions of the game, the rocket launcher, the noob tube is an attachment on a regular gun. In others, it's a secondary weapon.
So watch, you fire that over the building...
Like that's an actual weapon, what you're seeing here. Yeah. So it's not like a rifle with a rocket attachment. Right. It's a rocket launcher.
Right.
I live for these long like this stuff. I live for this stuff.
A noob tube compilation. Yep. Nice shot.
Yeah, I love it. Double kill. So it depends on the game. Not like this particular game. It's a separate weapon, not an attachment. And that's true of Black Ops 2.
Yeah, I'm going to go back, though, because we never really did see the end of the previous.
Yeah, right. What happens? I assume it comes back and hits the original guy.
That would. Yeah. Oh, Paul, you probably have telegraphed the conclusion of this.
I would hope so. I think that's going to be how it ends.
I think you have to work the words noob tubing into a regular story, like an Enterprise story.
Noob tubing.
Yeah, this one's going on for a while. These guys are still there.
A couple of games ago, they had a great Call of Duty game with a commercial with Dwight Howard.
Yeah,
and he was walking down the middle of the street with the noob tube, screaming at the top of his lungs. And then you know one of the other actors looks at he's like, "Oh, noob tuber."
Noob tuber. Yeah. That's when somebody says that, then you know they're in the know. This actually ends with a. Sigh, not a whisper, or a cry, not a whimper.
That's disappointing. So this is people don't understand the production value part of this.
They worked so hard, and what it could have done is got this guy back.
He could have caught it, like they could have done it in reverse and went back, and it was gun.
Yeah. Oh, that's been funny.
Yeah.
That would have been funny. Why didn't they do that? No. Kids today, they just don't have the same.
No, I'll just follow my feet on Xbox.com. I have some awesome noob tubing.
Your son actually called you a noob tuber?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. No,
because you have the diamond rocket launcher?
In our world, that is the biggest put down imaginable.
Oh.
Like, you're just a noob tuber.
Oh.
You know? It's, yeah. I accept it.
I bet Mary Jo's now just can't wait to get an Xbox One in.
No, I'm just thinking, like, I've got to find a way to work this into a story somehow.
Right.
Like, there's got to be a way.
That's the quintessential blogger. How can
Yahoo is the noob tuber of the tech world.
You're going to find a way, I guarantee
you. You're just mailing it in.
Our show is every Wednesday. I was late today, but generally we speak at 11 a.m. Pacific, 2 p.m. Eastern Time, 1900 UTC. Join us then. Chat. Watch live if you can't. On demand audio and video always available after the fact at twit.tv/WW or wherever you subscribe to finer podcasts, because we are the finest podcast of them all. Thank you, Paul. Thank you, Mary Jo. We'll see you next week on Windows Weekly. Bye-bye.